Good morning, Ms. Tisdale.
Good morning.
How are you? Good.
They put me in your corner today. They directed me to this location.
That's an interesting use of words.
It's three, right?
I'll try not to get in your way any more than
y'all doing?
Good, how are you?
You'll come out and see us as often as you used to.
Morning, Crystal.
Morning.
How are you?
Have you met Hillary?
I haven't. I'm Dana Miles.
Hillary? Yes.
Nice to meet you. I can remember those. My niece.
Yeah.
the rain because of the mermaid on the back.
There is a tense. Yes, sir. Get the nice cup you sixed.
Madlock. Never lose a case.
Lewis, I don't know about Lewis. Keep calling. Obviously, he's trying to get everyone calling. Lewis likes to tease people a little bit. Lewis likes to set high expectations.
I mean, it's really, I'll do whatever.
I've
got on
the
tour.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That's
fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, Stefan.
Nice to see you, Kevin.
Stefan, by Miles.
Yeah, nice to see you again, sir. Mayor?
Mayor Gravitt.
I recognize the face. Nice to see you, sir.
What are good things about your family? I only believe that you're foolish, really.
Good luck.
Thank you.
You too.
Judge's requesting now, if y'all can, if y'all do a swap check of tables, then we would not have any problems with the camera set up on the side or anything.
Okay.
As per the judge.
Okay.
She was here. She's gonna, yeah.
She's got unplugged. We're gonna do everything.
Yes, sir.
It's just going to take a little time because we had everything all plugged up and ready to go on this side. Now we're going to move it all to the other side.
Here.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Sorry, Kelly.
That's
fine.
Just undo it.
I just don't want to do it.
No, you can do that. You're going to pull that.
I didn't do
you weren't doing sure enough to kill everything.
This probably belongs to y'all. That probably belongs to y'all. Yeah, not belong to me.
I appreciate that.
I'm gonna move over here.
Room for two more.
Yeah, there's definitely room. Sorry.
Would y'all mind sleeping down just a little bit more? Thank you.
Jody? Yes, I do have that. Yeah. 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 It makes no sense. I also noticed that the Google Maps is different.
Yeah, they changed, they upgraded it, so what I did was I just uninstalled the most recent updates. Or it's kind of cheesy.
Nydia, you got the thing warmed up.
I'm going to swap back and find it.
Maybe some of us sit with them and some of them.
You good? No, we're not quite ready, but we're getting there.
I mean, is it working okay?
We don't know yet. We don't know. We've got to switch everything.
Slides, I'll give it to you. You'll have it here on the table as well.
All right.
Superior Court of Forsyth County is now in session. The Honorable Senior Judge Robert W. Adamson presiding.
Good morning. Be seated, please. First, let me tell you who I am, because although I've been in Forsyth County before on senior judge assignments, it's been a while. I'm Bob Adamson. I became a member of the bar after graduating from UGA Law School in 1971. I practiced law for 21 years. We had offices in Winda and Lawrenceville, and I covered generally Northeast Georgia. I went to the bench, or started doing Superior Court bench work as an assigned magistrate in 1992 after being elected to a Superior Court judgeship. I served until the end of 2008, at which time I retired and accepted senior status. I'm also a mediator, an arbitrator, and I do some special master work in addition to mediation and settlement conference work and senior judge assignments. I live in Bexar County between Winda and Watkinsville, which, if you know how to go, the Beaufort Dam Road is not too hard to get to. If you go the other highway, it takes a couple of hours to get here. So I took the Beaufort Dam Road and came right here with no problem at all this morning. Let me first ask the parties to introduce the folks at the table so I will know who I'm speaking to in regard to each of the issues that we're here to cover, the plaintiff in the case.
Sure, Your Honor, thanks for being here today and coming down from Winder. We appreciate it. I'm Kelly Campanella. I'm an Assistant Attorney General representing the Office of the Attorney General, Sam Olens, today. At council table with me is Senior Assistant Attorney General Stefan Ritter.
What's the name again?
Stefan Ritter.
Good morning, Your Honor. My name is Kevin Tallant. I am with Miles Patterson Hansford Tallant. We have the privilege to represent the City of Cumming. Along with me is my partner, Mr. Dana Miles, and Mayor H. Ford Gravitt of the City of Cumming. And the court may see me from time to time turning around, talking to the lady behind me. This is Ms. Lauren Giles, an associate with our firm. She is here with us also today.
All right, you don't have enough room to put her at the table.
Well, we'll make this work, Your Honor. We don't want to get things too crowded over here.
All right. Well, that's fine. However you want to deal with the problem. Thank you. Let's make sure first that we all are in agreement as to why we're here. The notice that I sent out in response to the suggestions of the parties was that we address the motion for summary judgment and the motion to dismiss, both of which are pleading motions and both of which are currently pending before the court. Both of these motions, as I understand it, are non-evidentiary motions. In other words, they'll be resolved on evidence which has been submitted without objection or otherwise admitted through the pleading process. So what we're not here for is a bench trial or an evidentiary hearing or any other form of evidence gathering or evidence weighing. I have reviewed, I had most of the relevant pleadings in hand because you sent it to me earlier this morning. I was a little bit late coming in here because I spent my time reviewing again the case file, and I think I have a pretty good grip on what is contained within the record. I recognize that first we're dealing with rather simple facts, but in some instances, very new. It's the first case I can recall where I've dealt with a statute that went into effect the same day the event occurred that's in question, which a portion of the statute in this case did. We may be dealing with some legal issues that we have to resolve in order to issue a correct ruling on the two motions that are pending in the case. The first thing I would like to do is have the parties, and I'll ask you both to just identify all of your pleadings that you consider to be relevant to the issues that I'm to decide today. As I say, I've reviewed the clerk's file, but the main thing I'm interested in is identifying the sources of evidence that have been duly admitted, since there's been no contested admission of evidence. I assume those that are duly admitted without objection, and I'll start with the plaintiff. What evidence have you duly admitted to this point that the court needs to consider?
Judge, we've submitted with our motion for summary judgment the affidavit of Nydia Tisdale. We also reference with some great extent the video taken by Ms. Tisdale on the day of the incident, April 17th, as well as the video that was taken by the city that same day. I think that's it.
Right.
Yeah. And those are our pieces of evidence.
All right. Any response to those items of evidence that I've had identified?
We have no responses to those pieces of evidence that the Attorney General has identified.
All right, then the affidavit of Ms. Tisdale and the two tapes are confirmed as having been admitted by the court and will be considered in resolving any issue that exists today. Now, Mr. Tallant, what items of evidence do you contend that you have submitted?
We have submitted, Your Honor, the four affidavits, the affidavit of Chief Tatum, the affidavit of Deputy Chief Cook, the affidavit of Mr. Davis, and the affidavit of Ms. Hamby. In addition to that, we have also, and I'm trying to do this from memory as best I can, based upon the references we've made in our pleadings, we have also referred to an audio recording that was produced to us during the course of discovery that contains a conversation between Ms. Tisdale, Dr. Joseph S. Moses, and a reporter named Aldo Naheed. I can't recall anything else that we have submitted at this point. Now, Judge, there is something that has come up within the last 30 days that we do intend to bring to the court's attention, which is in a different case, Ms. Tisdale's deposition was taken, and we have a copy of that. But that was not received by us until maybe just a week or so ago. 2 days ago is when we received the transcript of it, and so it is new. We have not, you know, Ms. Campanella, on behalf of the Attorney General's office, was there, was present at the deposition, but in terms of it being previously supplied to the court, today would be the first day that we would supply it. We have copies with us both for Your Honor and for Ms. Campanella.
Well, the issue is not whether it's been supplied to the court. The issue is whether or not it has been duly admitted for consideration as a part of this motion. That's why I'm doing what I'm doing
yes,
now,
is to make sure
that I don't wallow around in evidentiary matters that are not admitted and relevant for this purpose. Now, my offhand impression would be that if that's not submitted or legal court is not granted, that that is not in fact evidence that the court would consider today. Your response?
Your Honor, I would respond by saying that it is something, first of all, I'll obviously respect the court's ruling, whatever way you decide to go on it, but if this is not a situation where we have sandbagged or anything like that, but that position.
Oh, I'm strictly addressing the expectation set forth in the chapter on summary judgment and motions to dismiss on the pleadings
yes.
of the Civil Practice Act. That's where I'm sitting at this point.
I suppose my first question would be whether or not the Attorney General's office has any objection to the use of the deposition.
That was my next step. Do you have any objection to the use of that deposition?
Ultimately, if it's submitted, we can talk about it.
Judge, we haven't had a chance.
Let me reword to make sure my record's correct. I take it that the defendant is tendering before the court at this time the deposition to which he referred, which has not been previously made a part of the record. And he's doing so for purpose of consideration on the motion to dismiss and the motion for summary judgment. Do you have an objection to that tender?
Judge, we personally have not received a copy of the transcript. I was there for most of it. There was a portion I was not there for. So I think we would like an opportunity to review the transcript in its entirety before we admit it at this time.
Yeah, are there specific, usually when you're dealing with very several motions such as this, you're not concerned with the entire transcript, but only certain passages. Mm-hmm. Can you identify the relevant passage and let the counsel for the Attorney General identify those
passages? I've got a condensed copy. You got this is the full copy, so that you can see it easier. This is what I'm good to have. If I need to pull out just these pages, I'll see. This is part about.
I think the agreement we just reached, Your Honor, is that we could refer to it, give it to the court, noting that Ms. Tisdale, because we just got this a couple of days ago, she's not read and reviewed it yet herself. And so that's why I don't have the original transcript.
Is it a deposition that was taken before a registered or certified court reporter?
It was.
And has it experienced the period of response? In other words, has the court reporter served upon the testifying witness, either through counsel or otherwise, and has the time for a write up response passed?
The time for a write up response has not passed, Your Honor. And that's what I think we agreed to was that we could use it subject to that stipulation to the court.
All right, then I will find that the a write-up period has not passed other than the determination of any appropriate write-up, the document made a part of the record is the evidence case. So that...
There were a couple of others that my co-counsel pointed out to me. We have also submitted to the court phone records of Ms. Tisdale. These were attached as a in our response to the plaintiff's motion for summary judgment. And we also attached the version of House Bill 397, which passed the General Assembly. That's the one that contains the underlines for new words and the strike-throughs for
that. That doesn't need to be. That's not evidence. That's why
okay.
When the court has already reviewed that.
Thank you, Your Honor. I believe that concludes everything that that we need to discuss.
Your response to the phone records?
No objection to that, Judge.
All right, the phone records, to the extent that they've been identified, will likewise be considered as evidence for the purpose of these motions. We have two matters that are based on similar, but in some instances significant differences, and that is a motion to dismiss, which the court would identify as a motion for judgment on the pleadings, in which case the defendant is the movement. We have the summary judgment motion in which the plaintiff or complainant is the movement. Do you have any preferences to which order that we proceed on these matters? I believe the motion to dismiss was the first motion filed.
It was the first motion filed, Your Honor, and we also preferred to go first. My recommendation to the court, if I may be so bold in terms of argument, because the motion to dismiss contains those legal issues which are largely dispositive of the matters that are before the court today, it is our position that the motion to dismiss should be heard first, and then what I would suggest is the plaintiff would then be able to respond to that. The legal issues being largely the same, they could then include, if they want to, any additional things they feel they need to on their motion for summary judgment, after which we would respond with any factual issues that we think are on the motion for summary judgment. And then the plaintiff would then, as you know, because they have a motion as well, be able to do any kind of reply they believe is necessary. Trying to keep attorneys from only standing up twice, I understand, is always a challenge, but I think that could be an orderly way to present this, and I believe it makes sense considering the nature of the motions as well as the time in which they were filed.
Ms. Campanella, you
agree? Your Honor, that's fine by me. If he goes first, we have a chance come back, and then I come up and present my motion, my following right.
The main thing I don't want to do, and it's for my benefit, is to commingle the issues and the two motions in such a way that it becomes confusing to me.
Okay.
Let me, so that's the manner in which we'll proceed. We'll go first with the motion to dismiss our motion judgment on the pleadings, and we'll conclude that and follow with the summary judgment motion. Now, I want to simply read and verify with you two extremely relevant code sections which you refer to in whole or in part, and which I must refer to on each of these motions. One is I believe to be the current version of Georgia Code Annotated 50-14-5, which defines this court's jurisdiction. The superior courts of this state shall have jurisdiction to enforce compliance with the provisions of this chapter, including the power to grant injunctions or other equitable relief, in addition to any action that may be brought by any person, firm, corporation, or other entity, the Attorney General shall have authority to bring enforcement actions, either civil or criminal, in his or her discretion as may be appropriate to enforce compliance with this chapter. In any action brought to enforce the provisions of this chapter, in which the court determines that an agency acted without substantial justification in not complying with this statute, the court shall, unless it finds that special circumstances exist, assess in favor of the complaining party reasonable attorney's fees and other litigation costs reasonably incurred. Whether the position of the complaining party was substantially justified shall be determined on the basis of the record as a whole, which is made in the proceeding for which fees and other expenses are sought. Any agency or person who provides access to information in good faith reliance on the requirements of this chapter shall not be liable in any action on account of having provided access to such information. The other, maybe not only relevant, but the other primary code section is 50-14-6, which says any person knowingly and willfully conducting or participating in a meeting in violation of this chapter shall be guilty of a misdemeanor, and upon conviction shall be punished by a fine not to exceed $1,000. Alternatively, a civil penalty may be imposed by the court in any civil action brought pursuant to this chapter against any person who negligently violates the terms of this chapter in an amount not to exceed $1,000 for the first violation. A civil penalty or criminal fine not to exceed $2,500 per violation may be imposed for each additional violation that a violator commits within a 12-month period from the date of the first penalty or fine was imposed. It shall be a defense to any action under this code section that a person has acted in good faith in his or her actions. Now, there is, of course, the other relevant portion, which was amended on the action by the governor and legislature on April 17th, and I don't have the specific copy before me, but as I understand it, that code section requires that public meetings be first open to members of the public, and secondly, that members of the public be allowed to make visual or audio or sound, and I don't remember the specific words, visual or audio recordings of any such meetings. Now, those are the provisions that I think we're most keenly focused on in this matter today. Now, do I have any supplemental suggestions from either party, the movements?
I think that about covers it, Judge.
Yes, sir.
All right. If we could, let's start with the motion for dismissal or judgment on the pleadings. And I'll ask you, I know where you're going to start, and that's with sovereign immunity, and I want you to specifically quote the constitutional provision upon which you rely to help me from the very beginning.
Judge, we're going to be using a PowerPoint, and the court has a monitor, and if it pleases the court, at your request, I will do just that. I'll actually go to provision on sovereign immunity.
And in answer to the court's question, what I'm going to do is I'm going to point out two sections that we'll rely upon from the Constitution. The first one is Article 1, Section 2, Paragraph 9E, which says that the sovereign immunity of the state and its departments and agencies can only be waived by an act of the General Assembly, which specifically provides that sovereign immunity is thereby waived and the extent of the waiver. That's the first place we'll be looking to for sovereign immunity, and I'll explain more of that in my argument if it pleases the court. And then the second place where we will be looking to the grant or the recognition of sovereign immunity of the City of Cumming in the Constitution is Article 9, Section 2, Paragraph 9. This is in the Constitution. The General Assembly may waive the immunity of counties, municipalities, and school districts by law. Those two sections, and I'll be referring to them and explaining them in my argument.
All right, let me go back one step, and I intended to address this before I started the argument, but to be honest, I forgot it. Who are we?
We?
I guess, let me tell you what my concern is, and it goes all the way back to Professor Perry Centel. I didn't have him for torts, but I had him for municipal corporations many, many years ago, and I remember distinctly that he told me that cities, counties, authorities are subdivisions or agencies of the state. They are creations of the legislature of the state, and they're essentially subparts of the state. In this action, other than the fact that it also individually addresses the mayor and the complaint, is an action by a state agency against another state agency and a person acting within the responsibility or authority of that sub-agency. Is there something different about who we are?
We, in this case, Your Honor, I think I understand the court's question, but we are the City of Cumming. The City of Cumming is who is relying upon the immunity defense in this case. And I'll add, and I'm sure the court remembers this from Professor Centel's class as well, that the mayor has also been sued in his official capacity.
And a representative capacity.
Exactly. And when he is sued in his official capacity, he is entitled to those same sovereign immunity defenses to which the government that he is representing is entitled.
I guess the reason that I brought that issue up is not to suggest that it's that who you are might modify your right to sovereign immunity, but when the Constitution addresses sovereign immunity, does it talk about, or is it intended to talk about immunity for legislatively authorized actions between units of the same government? That's a good question.
It's a good question. I actually intend to address it in my argument.
Okay, good. That's the main thing I wanted to do.
I'll take care of that, Your Honor.
Make sure you take care of that.
I will. I'll absolutely take care of that. Does the court have any more preliminary questions?
Not that I can remember at the moment.
Okay, thank you, Your Honor. I don't mind being interrupted, so please don't hesitate. First of all, thank you, Judge. I mean, you can tell from the group that's here, and the court's already recognized, this is a case that's going to be interpreting for the first time new language that was passed into effect or was signed into effect on the very day the alleged violation took place. It's an important case, and we certainly thank the court for being willing to do that. And I'll say on behalf of all the counsel, we're also very happy that the court is able at this point to come forward and to hear the argument. We're certainly appreciative of that.
I'll give you, Judge, a brief roadmap of where I'm going to go. And you know, we've talked about it a little bit already, so I'll hurry through that. We filed our motion to dismiss. There's obviously also the plaintiff's motion for summary judgment. And our motion to dismiss is based upon three grounds: statutory construction issues, the issue of the sovereign immunity of the City of Cumming, and then the issue of the qualified immunity of Mayor Gravitt. Then later on, we'll have the plaintiff's motion for summary judgment, and I believe that the legal issues are going to be the same. In fact, I'm virtually certain they are. But we do believe that later on we'll be presenting additional issues of fact as well. That's kind of my roadmap for the entire day. By way of a brief factual background, on April 17th, 2012, the same day that Governor Deal signed into law the new version of the Open Meetings Act, there was a meeting of the mayor and council of the City of Cumming. At the start of the meeting, there was a camera set up in the middle aisle, at the rear of the, not in the aisle, but at the rear of the City Hall meeting room in the middle aisle of the chambers. And the mayor directed the police chief to remove the camera. Over protest from the person manning the camera, the chief of police removed the video camera to the rear and side of the chambers. During this entire time, the City of Cumming was recording video. The person whose camera was removed to the rear and side of the chambers was told not to record. No dispute about any of those facts. You mentioned earlier, from a factual standpoint, a lot of this is very simple, straightforward, and admitted. And that's the case, as I just explained. The Attorney General has brought claims, and what they're alleging is that the City of Cumming has violated the Open Meetings Act by doing three things. Number one is not allowing the meeting to be video recorded. The second is allegedly removing the person who was recording the meeting from the council chambers. And I use the word allegedly intentionally there. And then the third is not allowing the meeting to be video recorded a second time on the same night. And upon this basis, the plaintiff is seeking the following fines. And this is one of those things that was new to the law. At OCGA 50-14-6, this is one of those provisions that was new on the day in question. Prior to April 17th, this ability to sue someone and try and have a fine assessed against them in that lawsuit.
Let me interrupt them again. I don't mean to be intrusive, but I've struggled with the distinction between fine and civil penalty. The code section, I noted, and it's kind of like the struggle we always have between civil and criminal contempt. That most Superior Court judges, even those with 20 or more years service, readily admit that they're still confused about what's civil contempt and what's criminal contempt. The code section identifies a fine not to exceed $1,000 related to a misdemeanor conviction which is directly connected with the burden of proving knowingly and willfully participating in a meeting which is in violation of this chapter. I don't know of any criminal action that has been brought in this case.
None has. Fine.
So the section we're concerned with relates to, and this is where I really get confused, a civil penalty imposed against, and I know what your argument is regarding person, against any person who negligently violates the terms of this chapter in an amount not to exceed $1,000 for the first violation. Strange language. So go ahead.
Thank you, Your Honor. That's the first provision they have sought to use in this case, is OCGA 50-14-6. The second thing that has been raised in this case is injunctive relief, 50-14-5. And I want to address this very briefly Your Honor, we believe that this issue, the question of injunctive relief, it is not properly before the court today. And there's a very specific reason for that. And I'm sure Ms. Campanella will have a response to this. And the reason we don't believe the court can grant injunctive relief today is because, one, there's been no evidentiary hearing on the issue of injunctive relief. I mean, we have an agreement, and the court recognized it since we got here this morning. We're not here for an evidentiary hearing on this issue. The second reason, Your Honor, though, is because we wanted to, in this case, the City of Cumming intended eventually to bring its own motion for summary judgment on certain issues. We tried to take, and I'm sure Ms. Campanella will agree that all the facts I'm about to say happened. We tried to take Ms. Tisdale's deposition in this case. An objection was lodged to us doing that on the theory that our motion to dismiss, as the court has called it, our motion for judgment on the pleadings, was going to be dispositive of the issues of the case. It would resolve the issues of the case. And if we prevailed on that, there would be no need for us to take Ms. Tisdale's deposition. We then...
Have I missed something? I did not observe any notice of deposition or motion for protective order within the file of the case. Is that...
What did happen, Your Honor, is this court in February entered an order that recognized that our motion on the pleadings could be dispositive of the case, and so you stayed discovery in this matter.
Okay.
And so we...
So it's not pending before the court, okay.
It's right. There's not any kind of protective order pending before the court. We reached an agreement, which was that, hey, we'll go and we will not take her deposition until after the motion for judgment on the pleadings has been decided. The reason I bring that up is because we've not been allowed to complete discovery, and I'm fine with that, but I don't believe the court should enter anything on injunctive relief until we've had that ability. We firmly believe that after we've had that ability, we will be able to bring a motion for summary judgment on the issue of injunctive relief. I'm wary of going further into it than to say that, because it's going to require me to talk about things that aren't in the record, and I want to respect the court's already clear admonition of saying this is what's in the record. I don't want to go beyond that. But I do ask that the court consider the fact that because of the motion to stay discovery and then the court's order staying discovery, we weren't able to complete our discovery, and we think that after we did, we would be in a position to bring a summary judgment argument on the issue of injunctive relief. And I'll just tell the court what the ground would be. It's mootness. And so I'd ask, that's the last thing I'll say about injunctive relief for the day, and I'll move on from there. And the final thing the Attorney General has asked in this case is that we that the court impose attorney's fees against the defendants in this action. Turning first to that.
Bring up a point that I noted. The attorney fee provision in 1514.5 concludes with these words: whether the position of the complaining party was substantially justified shall be determined on the basis of the record as a whole, which is made in the proceeding for which the fees and other expenses are sought. Now, we're not going to have a record as a whole if we have anything beyond this consideration today. So if we terminate the entire case today, the issue of attorney's fees and expenses would be right. If we do not terminate the entire case today, the expenses and attorney's fees would have to wait for determination after the entire record of the case is established. Now, do y'all both agree with that?
Yes, sir.
I do. I suppose the question that I would have then for the court is, I am prepared later on to talk about the attorney's fees motion. That's part of their motion for summary judgment. I'm not going to deal with it in my motion to dismiss, obviously.
Well, I'll ask you to simply bifurcate that until we see if we've hit a situation where the entire action, either on their motion or yours, is terminated today. If that's the case, then we'll go into the issue of attorney's fees.
I will do that without hesitation, Your Honor.
All right.
I want to turn first to the action that's brought against the city, and I want to talk about what makes up this claim. I mentioned this briefly earlier. The first is the suit against the City of Cumming proper is part of this claim. It's also the action against the mayor in his official capacity. He's a representative of the government. He's been sued in that capacity. This was a point, I think, of some confusion maybe in some of the pleadings, but the principle is very clear and has been stated multiple times by our courts, that the defenses, including sovereign immunity of a government entity, also apply to suits against their officials in their official capacity. So to the extent the City of Cumming has defenses in this case, those defenses also belong to the mayor being sued in his official capacity. The reason I bring that up is because I'm not going to stand up and every time I talk about a defense of the City of Cumming, I'm not going to say, and it also applies to the mayor sued in his official capacity, because number one, that makes my argument longer than it already is going to be, and number two, I don't believe it's necessary. I believe the law states that, so I won't be constantly going back and referring to the suit in his official capacity. Getting to what the court wanted to talk about very early on, which is sovereign immunity, it's found in Article 1, Section 2, Paragraph 9E. And I've already read it once, but the sovereign immunity of the state and its departments and agencies can only be waived by an act of the General Assembly, which specifically provides that sovereign immunity is thereby waived in the extent of that waiver. Now, in the very last pleading filed in this case by the plaintiff makes the assertion, but they don't cite any authority for this position, that we, the City of Cumming, have relied upon the wrong provision of the Constitution. They say this provision of the Constitution doesn't apply to the City of Cumming because it applies to the state, its departments, and agencies. There was no citation to that, but when someone makes a statement like that, I want to go and try and figure out what it is they're talking about. And what I found was that in the mid-1990s, the Georgia Supreme Court issued several decisions that frankly, threw stare decisis out the window. And they literally, in a series of about three decisions, went back and forth and back and forth over whether or not this provision applies to cities, counties, school boards, those types of entities. They were so confused about it that the Georgia Court of Appeals, and I thought this was a great quote, so I wanted to point it out today, in the case of Bitterman versus Atkins, and that's at 217 Georgia App 652, the 1995 case. Here's what the Court of Appeals said about the Supreme Court's rulings. Stare decisis is like a train ticket. Good for this date and this train only. Tomorrow will be a new day and we will need a new ticket and we will not be bound by what a full bench decided yesterday or 300 years ago. So it was clear at this point in the mid-90s, and I emphasize in the mid-90s, there was some confusion about what the sovereign immunity of an entity like the City of Cumming was. That's since been resolved. And I would point the court to the 2003 case of CSX Transportation Inc. versus the City of Garden City, it's a municipality, which says the law requires immunity to be specifically waived. That's the law we've quoted in our brief. It's the law of the state of Georgia. It is and has been the entire time. Our argument has not changed at all based upon that, given the City of Garden City case against CSX Transportation. After the Attorney General said we relied upon the wrong provision, they said this is the provision we should have relied upon, which is that the General Assembly may waive the immunity of counties, municipalities, and school districts by law. I'm going to go ahead and adopt this provision as well, as I said I would earlier, because one thing it does is it clearly confirms in the Constitution ratified by the people of the state of Georgia that the City of Cumming has immunity. If it didn't have immunity, there wouldn't need to be a constitutional provision saying that the immunity can be waived. And it requires legislative action in order to waive that immunity. And here's the important thing, Your Honor. Not only is legislative action required to waive that immunity, the burden is upon the plaintiff to prove that immunity has been waived. It's not an affirmative defense that I have the burden of proof on. The burden of proof is upon the plaintiff to show that clear, specific waiver of sovereign immunity. How in the world the General Assembly waived it? And there are two cases for that, again, both involving cities, because I know there's been some issue about me not citing enough municipality cases in this case. Scott versus City of Valdosta, 280 Georgia App 481, that's a 2006 case. And Albertson versus City of Jessup, 312 Georgia App 246, that's a 2011 case.
Let me interrupt again.
Yes, sir.
And throw in an inquiry, which I think is essential. Can you identify for me any appellate decision which addresses sovereign immunity in a case filed by either the state or another state agency against an agency or subdivision of the state?
I cannot identify an appellate case. I have not found an appellate case on that issue.
If you can find an appellate case on that issue, you may save both this court and the appellate courts a lot of time in trying to resolve these issues.
And that's the point I think the court was getting at earlier, and I'm going to talk about that. And here's the thing, Judge. Well, I tell you what, I don't want to get too far out of line on my argument, so if it's okay.
No, I don't mean to interrupt you.
No, it's fine.
I guess I'm keying on certain things.
Yes, sir. I understand. I understand, Your Honor. Here is, getting back to the Open Meetings Act briefly, the Open Meetings Act, we've covered that the city has sovereign immunity. We've covered that a legislative action is required to waive it. And as far as the Open Meetings Act goes, it is silent on the issue of sovereign immunity. The word sovereign, the word immunity, the phrase sovereign immunity are nowhere in the Open Meetings Act, anywhere.
Does the Constitution, other than these code sections you've cited, or any case decided upon the constitutional authority, clearly define sovereign immunity?
Well, sovereign immunity is immunity from suit in the first place. I mean, that's what sovereign immunity means.
I mean, I know that's what you believe, and that's probably what I believe, but has the drafter of the Constitution or the appellate court ever specifically defined what sovereign immunity is?
Sovereign immunity, I can't cite to the court as I stand here a case that says this is sovereign immunity. But I can tell you that what the cases we have cited talk about, and I'm going to quote some of those, is that sovereign immunity is the freedom of being subject to the suit in the first place. It's the right of the government to be free from the actual lawsuits. And Judge, that gets to the point, now I'll hit on this, but that gets to the point of what the court is getting at about can the state sue. It's not a question of who the plaintiff is. It's a question of the fact that a lawsuit was brought. And what the Constitution says is no lawsuit can be brought, period.
Let me interrupt again, and I guess I'm really creating stumbling blocks along your way, and I don't intend to be.
That's fine, Your Honor.
Obstructive, but prior to April 17th, in the amendment of statute, how were enforcement actions originated that were originated by the attorney general to enforce the existing provision? provisions of the Open Records Act?
They would have been originated in an action that was seeking equitable relief. And there is specific Supreme Court precedent that says that you can bring an action against someone, but it would be against the city or the mayor in his official capacity for equitable relief to force him to do his job. And that's
So up until April the 17th, every enforcement action was an equitable action, either seeking mandamus or injunctive relief. There was no such animal as a civil action or a legal action, I should say, seeking any kind of penalty fine or other recourse. So this case is indeed the first case brought in a court sitting as a court of law as opposed to a court sitting as a court in equity. Is that correct?
That is correct. That is correct. I will tell the court I have no idea whether the Attorney General's office or any prosecutor ever tried to bring misdemeanor action against someone. And that's another enforcement mechanism, but that obviously sits outside. Sovereign immunity doesn't give someone immunity from crimes. It prevents immunity from suit. And because it prevents immunity from suit, that's why I'm focused on this new provision upon which the plaintiff is relying in this case.
All right, let me ask you another question to clarify.
I like this. It's like law school.
Well, and I don't intend to be that way.
No, it's fine. I'm serious. I
simply want to ask the questions while they occur to me or of questions that have already occurred to me. And let me get back. And now you've done to me what I'm doing to you.
I'm sorry.
Go ahead. I'll think of it in a minute.
I apologize, Your Honor. I wanted to make really clear at the outset, I'm not standing up here saying...
I know what the question was.
Okay, I'll take it.
Prior to April the 17th, had there been any instances or was there any authority for anyone other than the Attorney General to bring an enforcement action on the Open Records Act? In other words, was the door open for third parties to become plaintiffs by the April 17th Act?
I think that, first let me address, I do believe that a private party could have brought through an application process, an arrest warrant. An arrest warrant, first of all. That happened to be the code section I had open. I do believe a private party could have brought an arrest warrant. Can you give me the revised version?
Could a private party have sought injunctive relief? And I assume they could have, on the general ground, sought mandamus prior to April 17th. But were they specifically referred to as potential parties in the Open Meetings Act prior to April 17th?
What 5014.5 said, I do not believe there was any change in this, and that's what I'm actually flipping to right now. It gave, 5014.5 gave the Superior Courts jurisdiction to enforce compliance with the power to grant injunctions or other equitable relief. And then it said that in addition to any action that may be brought by any person, firm, or corporation, the Attorney General could. So the answer is yes. So a person could have brought one of those, could have sought the court's assistance in equity, essentially, prior to April 17th of 2012.
But the existence of an action at law was created by the April 17th.
That's correct.
Okay, that's satisfied. Go ahead.
I wanted to say at this point, when I talked about how the Open Meetings Act does not mention anything about sovereign immunity, I'm not saying that the state can't regulate meetings. The state can regulate meetings, and there are valid ways the state could enforce it. We talked about them this morning. The issue that I'm raising is that in sovereign immunity, the Open Meetings Act is perfectly silent with respect to the ability to have a fine issued against the City of Cumming. It's the, in fact, the City of Cumming or cities or agencies is what the law uses, are not even mentioned in OCGA 50-14-6, and therefore there can be no waiver of the city's sovereign immunity as it pertains to that. I also want to point out that the Attorney General in their response pleadings also told us that really the genesis of sovereign immunity in the state of Georgia comes from this, OCGA 36-33-1. That's not the case. What I think they have argued is that this is the genesis of the city's sovereign immunity. This is in a provision of the code that applies only to municipal corporations. And if I've understood their argument correctly, I think what they've said is this is where the General Assembly gave the city sovereign immunity. And what they've argued is that it applies only to actions for damages. In other words, the city is only has immunity to actions for damages. But that's not what the law says. In the CSX case that I cited earlier, what the court said was this code section is not a grant of sovereign immunity, it is a limited waiver of sovereign immunity. It's a limited waiver. The court recognizes the city has sovereign immunity from suit, and the General Assembly gave in this a limited waiver regarding damages. Chapter 92 that's referred to there deals with automobile cases where you've purchased automobile liability insurance. That's why this is not a grant of sovereign immunity, it's a limited waiver of sovereign immunity, and that distinction can't be ignored. The law...
Let me throw you a curve there.
Please do.
Where in this action is there a claim or jurisdiction of this court to consider or grant relief for damage?
There isn't.
All right.
There's not. That's a point that I'm going to hit on pretty hard here in just a minute. Of course, where we get to is what happens if sovereign immunity is not waived. We know the city's got it. The question is, has it been waived? The court dismisses the case, and this has been the holding time and time again. I've cited four cases here to deal with it. I added one involving a city, Albertson versus City of Jessup, 312 Georgia App 246, a 2011 case. And the reason that you dismiss, and this has also been a bone of contention in the pleadings, the reason you dismiss is because when sovereign immunity applies, the court lacks subject matter jurisdiction. The city is not subject to suit. The sovereign is not subject to suit, and so there is no subject matter jurisdiction. One of the arguments the Attorney General has raised in this case is that, oh yes, there is subject matter jurisdiction. It's granted in OCGA 50-14-5. But my response to that is very straightforward. Your Honor has jurisdiction in almost any kind of a case that could come up. Your Honor would have had jurisdiction in the Crisp County School System versus Brown case. I believe that's the case that dealt with a school safety plan. You would have had it in the Albertson versus City of Jessup case. You would have had it in Ray Carter. You would have had it in the CSX transportation case I relied upon earlier. That was a case that dealt with contract. But you have the jurisdiction. The General Assembly gave it to you. But sovereign immunity says when it applies, subject matter jurisdiction is lost. It doesn't matter if the General Assembly says you have subject matter jurisdiction over something when sovereign immunity applies, because that's the reason, that's the genesis, that's the legal theory. The city is not subject to suit, therefore there is no subject matter jurisdiction to hear the case. It's essentially, when you get right down to it, it's essentially a separation of powers issue. That's the theory behind the dismissal of the case. Here's where the court wanted to go earlier, which is that the issue of, well, does sovereign immunity apply when it is another entity of government that is bringing an action, a legal action for the imposition of a penalty, a suit against the city? And the word that was used in the pleadings to describe the defenses we have raised has been audacious. That we are being audacious in even raising this issue, because this is the state that is bringing this action against the City of Cumming. Well, I have two responses to that. Number one is, nowhere in the law does anything say, City of Cumming, you have sovereign immunity unless the state is the plaintiff. The court wanted me to come up with a case, and Ms. Giles is going to look for one. I don't think there's a case out there on this issue. But the court wanted me to provide a case which says that whether or not this does apply when the state is the one bringing the action. Does sovereign immunity apply when the state is the one bringing the action? And my response to the court initially is, nothing says it doesn't. You see, the burden of proof to prove the waiver is upon the plaintiff. They're the ones who have to come forward and show the court somewhere where sovereign immunity has been waived. And in this action, it doesn't exist. It doesn't exist in the Open Meetings Act, and there is absolutely nowhere in the Constitution or in any statute does it say, City of Cumming, your sovereign immunity is limited by the fact that if the state brings the action, then you don't get sovereign immunity. And I think that's important for the court to consider. The question is not whether or not the issue has been decided before. The question is whether or not that blanket sovereign immunity that was granted has been waived in any way, shape, or form, and it's not. The second thing that I would point out is that the argument has been made that it's the state that gave the City of Cumming its sovereign immunity. It's the state that gave the City of Cumming this defense to suit, so you can't raise it against the state. Well, in addition to the fact there has been no waiver of that sovereign immunity, the other key critical point is that's wrong. The city's sovereign immunity does not come from the state. And that's why the state's existence as a plaintiff doesn't matter. The city's sovereign immunity comes from the Constitution, which come from the people of the state of Georgia that ratified it. That's a key point. It does not matter that the state is the plaintiff, because they're no different from the City of Cumming in this analysis. And they're not the genesis of that sovereign immunity. The genesis of that sovereign immunity is the Constitution, which came not from the state, but from the people. So that's my response to that question. There is nothing that says, City of Cumming, you have sovereign immunity, unless it's the state that brings the suit. And the genesis of the sovereign immunity isn't the state. It's the people who ratified the Constitution. That's our sovereign immunity defense. I'm going to hit on our statutory construction defense briefly, because I've touched on it a little bit already. No civil fine is authorized against the City of Cumming. The civil fine provision, and the court read this in its entirety earlier, I'm going to quote a portion of it now, says a civil penalty may be imposed in any civil action against any person who negligently violates this chapter. A person, not a city. More importantly, not an agency. Because under the Open Meetings Act, the City of Cumming is not regarded as a person, but is rather regarded as an agency. And the Open Meetings Act by the General Assembly treated agencies and persons differently. Sometimes, such as in OCGA 50-14-5C, the General Assembly said, an agency or person who provides, and that's the portion that says, an agency or person who provides information in reliance upon this act shall not be liable therefore. So it uses both terms in the same sentence. If an agency and a person are the same thing, there is absolutely no reason to use both of those terms in that sentence. The General Assembly again does it, 50-14-5B, where it says any action that may be brought by any person, firm, corporation, or other entity. It uses all of those terms to make sure it encompasses all of those entities. If they meant the same thing, there would be no need to do that. I actually was reminded when the court
read the entire provision this morning from 5014-5, 6, 50-14-5-6 provides not only for a civil penalty against a person, but it also provides for a misdemeanor against a person. In the same statute, the word person is used multiple times. And when it's used, they can't bring a misdemeanor action against the City of Cumming. They can bring it against a person. They can't bring a misdemeanor against the City of Cumming. And here, what it says is any person can be guilty of a misdemeanor, and any person can have a fine imposed upon them. But it never says agency. Anywhere in the Open Meetings Act, there's nowhere in the Open Meetings Act is there an authorization for a civil suit for a fine at law against an agency, and that includes the City of Cumming. In response to this, the Attorney General relies upon the Citizens United versus Federal Election Commission case for the proposition that it is possible within the world of statutory construction for a person and an artificial entity to be the same thing. That's what the United States Supreme Court held in Citizens United.
Let me lead you back to
my
struggle in that regard, and I've read both subdivisions of the statute earlier. The penalty is imposed in a criminal action against any person who willfully, I believe it says, and wantonly participates in a meeting in violation of this statute.
Yes, sir.
Criminal conduct, willful action, fine, all criminal components that we're not concerned with here, but directed again, as you said, at a person, not a corporate entity or an agency. The second provision troubles me even more because it doesn't fit within my book of knowledge, and that is it imposes or gives the court, says the court may, which doesn't require, but gives the court the power to impose a defined civil penalty of $1,000 for one violation, again, against any person, but it prefaces person with a troubling word, negligently violates the terms of this statute. Which, does that mean it's restrictive only where a person acts within the taught definition of negligence in violating this statute? What if the person willfully violates the statute? Does that mean that it's only addressed by a criminal penalty, or does that mean that it can be addressed by the Attorney General or a citizen in either type of action?
My response to that would be that the General Assembly drafted language, and the only time they've authorized a civil penalty is for a negligent action. They've not authorized a civil action for anything else.
Would it make sense that they would allow a civil penalty for something which is merely negligent and deny a civil penalty for something that is willful or wanton?
I suppose in that case, Your Honor, and I'm going to be frank with the court, that's probably, and I'm going to get into this in a minute, that is probably the kind of situation where the general, you should construe this to have a broad remedial purpose language would come in. The General Assembly, in drafting this statute, and I obviously have a lot of issues with the way this statute was put together. There's a lot of language in it I don't like and I don't think is clear. But if there was going to be a situation, and I'm going to hit on this in a minute, where a broad
purpose was to be considered. This might be that kind of situation.
What, how does the, give me the definition of a civil action.
Now this really is like law school. It would be an action brought pursuant either to this court's equitable or legal powers that does not involve criminal sanctions, that seeks the redress of some wrong. It's what we have in this case. It's a situation, and this gets to why we have sovereign immunity and official immunity. It's the process by which we have cases brought where discovery happens, where people have to go through depositions, where people sit through hearings like the one we're sitting here through today.
Let me stop you for just a minute and let me struggle trying to get back to the definition in Title IX of a civil action. I looked at it earlier and now I can't find it. Where's the intern? There you are. Can you find the portion of the of Title IX that defines civil action? I looked at it earlier this morning, but I totally lost it. I think it's in the first provision of Title IX, which I did not bring in the courtroom with me, so it would be probably 9-1 or 9-2.
I found it, Your Honor. Civil action means an action founded on private rights, either from contract or tort. And I have a new argument to interject based upon that, frankly, which is that the General Assembly authorized something that doesn't exist under the law. A civil action is an action founded on private rights arising from either contract or tort. And this is not either. This is not a tort action, it's not a contract action. This is,
and you've just adopted the argument that the Attorney General is going to give you back on sovereign immunity.
Which is that it doesn't apply. Well, I mean, no, I'm not, because we're immune from suit. See, the sovereign immunity argument, Your Honor, does not say that we are immune from civil action. Sovereign immunity says we are immune from suit unless there has been a specific waiver.
Are there other suits in Georgia other than civil action?
Well, the General Assembly has tried to create one. And if they have tried to create one by enacting this code section, we are immune not from civil actions, but from suit to begin with.
9-11-2 says there shall be one form of action to be known as a civil action.
Well, and again, that's again where I get back to the General Assembly has tried to create something that is not recognized in the law, which is a civil action to impose a fine. If they try to do something that's not allowed in law without amending that law, if they were successful in doing it, we still have immunity because we're not only immune from civil actions, we are immune from suit. And that's the language of the Supreme Court when interpreting sovereign immunity. Getting back really quickly to the Citizens United case, which is where I left off, I'm not saying that in the world of statutory construction that there can never be a situation where an agency and a person are the same thing. What I am saying is, and the last time I checked, Citizens United did not pass upon the language used by the Georgia General Assembly in the Open Meetings Act. What I'm saying is, when you look at the Georgia Open Meetings Act, an agency and a person are not the same thing, and therefore there can be no fine issued against the City of Cumming. Turning to
let's deviate just a minute from the new section regarding fines and civil penalties, and let's go back to the old section which authorized enforcement actions for injunctive relief. If there is immunity of all suits and actions, why did the legislature spend all of its time creating an open meetings law which had absolutely no applicability to cities and counties and authorities, all of whom are agencies of the state?
Your question is,
is there anything that's enforceable?
The criminal provisions.
I guess you say that within the definition of sovereign immunity, equitable actions are excluded. Is that?
The Supreme Court has said that an equitable action is excluded. So I'm not here today to say that sovereign.
But you used the word suit earlier, and your reference to sovereign immunity, and that would include equitable and legal action.
Yes, it would. I want to make sure that I'm not misleading the court, though, because what I'm getting at is the Supreme Court has said that there can be an action against a person in their official capacity to force them to do that which the law requires them to do.
That's a mandate.
Exactly. You can have that. There's not a mandamus count in this case.
And you can also stop them from doing something which the law prohibits.
Yes.
Which is injunction.
Yes. Turning to the mayor's official immunity, this is a huge code section. I'm going to skip through as much of it as I can. Actually, I probably won't, because it's huge, but it's very laden with important things for this case. All officers, employees of the state or its departments and agencies may be subject to suit and may be liable for injuries and damages caused by their negligent performance or failure to perform ministerial functions, and they may be liable for injuries and damages if they act with actual malice or actual intent to cause injury in regards to their official functions. Except as otherwise provided in this subparagraph, they shall not be subject to suit or liability, and no judgment shall be entered against them for the performance or non-performance of their official functions. That's a very broad grant of official immunity. The first thing that the Attorney General said in response is they've said again that we've relied upon the wrong code section. They say this only applies to employees of the state, which departments or agencies, and municipalities aren't part of that. That's wrong. And there are two specific cases dealing with municipal officers, one of them, a mayor, saying that this is the source for official immunity for persons holding that office. The first one I would cite to is Williams versus Solomon, 242 Georgia App 807. That's a 2000 case. A municipal officer was protected from personal liability for discretionary actions taken within the scope of his official authority, citing this provision of the Constitution. And the second one was Common Cause Georgia versus City of Atlanta, 279 Georgia 480. That's a 2005 case citing this provision of the Constitution for the official immunity of former Mayor Bill Campbell of Atlanta. And that was a contract, that dealt with the contract issue. Only can be liable for injuries or damages, otherwise not subject to suit and shall not be liable. And this is the correct principle of official immunity that applies to Mayor Gravitt in this case, as those two cases held. This is, I've hit on this.
Put that back up just a minute, 11.
Two different categories drawn, and I'm going to get into whether this was an official function or a ministerial function, if that's what the court's asking. I'm getting into that. I absolutely am. But I'll point this out first, which is that in this case, it really doesn't matter. It doesn't matter whether Mayor Gravitt was doing a ministerial function. It doesn't matter whether Mayor Gravitt was performing an official function. Because under this, he can only be liable for injuries or damages. And if he's not, if there are no injuries or damages, what the law says is, except, I'm about halfway down, except as provided in this subparagraph, officers and employees of the state or its department agencies shall not be subject to suit or liability. And then at the very bottom, the provisions of this subparagraph shall not be waived. The General Assembly can try to waive this. They can try to make Mayor Gravitt subject to suit for something besides injuries or damages. But this provision says, of the Constitution says, they can't do it. And it's a proviso as old as the state itself. The General Assembly's power is supreme except as to matters that violate the Constitution of the state of Georgia or the Constitution of the United States. And making Mayor Gravitt subject to suit or a penalty that doesn't involve injuries or damages is prohibited by the Constitution. I point that out because, well, I'll get to that in a second. I want to get first to the lack of injury or damage. Here's what I was just saying. Constitutional provision says that he can only be liable for injuries or damages. No provision says that he can be subject to suit for what is a civil fine or even a civil penalty, which is what the case at bar seeks. And the Attorney General's complaint is absolutely devoid of any allegation of injury or damage. And the Attorney General admits this on page 5 and on page 9 of their brief in response to our motion to dismiss. The Attorney General states unequivocally, this is not an action for injury or damage. Case closed, it's done. Sovereign official immunity bars this complaint against Mayor Gravitt. He's just not subject to it. The General Assembly did something or tried to do something that as to Mayor Gravitt, they are prohibited by the Constitution from doing. That's why I'm going to get into the official function argument because I think it's illustrative of what he was dealing with on the day in question. But it really doesn't matter because there's no allegation of injury or damage. I wanted to get to something because I know the court has struggled with this whole what is official immunity, what is sovereign immunity, why do we have these things, what are they? As I mentioned earlier, it's immunity from the suit in the first place. And I think it's important to remember why we have this. And this is from Cameron versus Lane, 274 Georgia 122. The shorthand version of it is, we don't want public officials being afraid of their own shadow. The reason we grant official immunity is because we're trying to preserve their independence of action without fear of constant lawsuits or constant review of the judgment calls they make through the court system in perfect hindsight. That's why we have this concept of official immunity in the first place. That's why he is free from suit, because we don't want situations where every time somebody makes a decision, they're constantly second-guessing themselves as to whether or not they did the right thing at that moment in time. I'm going to scroll through this slide quickly because I've already gone through it. The lack of injury or damage in this case, because there's no injury or damage, this suit is barred as to Mayor Grader. Here's what the court was hinting at: official immunity. Do we have that in this case because there's a lack of malice or actual intent to cause injury? And I said, yes, we do, because the question then becomes, was Mayor Gravitt acting in an official capacity or a ministerial capacity? The question is whether or not presiding over a legislative body is an official function. I can't think of a more official function than presiding over a legislative body. I mean, that's what we're dealing with here. When Casey Cagle picks up the gavel in Atlanta to run the Senate, he is running a legislative body. That is an official function. We don't look at every minute detail of every single tiny decision that goes on. What we do is we say, what was the man doing? If he was running a legislative body meeting, it's an official function. And that's exactly what Mayor Gravitt was doing in this case. The City of Cumming Council is the legislative body, the governing authority of the City of Cumming. He was running that meeting. It's an official function. There can be, even if there was injury and damage, which we know there's not, there still could be no liability against him without a showing of actual malice or actual intent to cause injury. And we don't have either of those in this case. There is not a case, I'll go ahead and tell the court, I've looked for it pretty hard, which says that presiding over a legislative body in the state of Georgia is an official function. I would submit to the court, the reason there is no case law upon that is because it's so obvious. When someone is running a meeting like that, that's an official function. There is, however, a case from Maryland, and this was the only case I could find, that dealt with whether or not running a meeting was an official function. We cited this in our briefs. Maryland's law on official immunity is very similar to Georgia's. And here's why it's an official function. Because he's charged with running the meeting, making quick decisions, preserving order, evaluating the rules of the assembly and the laws applicable to it, calling for the exercise of personal deliberation and judgment, which in turn entails examining the facts and reaching reasoned conclusions and acting on them in a way not specifically directed. He's got a lot of things going on at once, and he is in charge of all of them. That's why when he's running a meeting, he is entitled to official immunity under the official function provision of official immunity.
Can you help us with the definition of official function by looking to previous definitions of ministerial function?
Ministerial functions would be those which are just automatic. There is absolutely no call or exercise for discretion whatsoever. It is something that is based upon a preset standard of facts from which there can be no deviation and no judgment made at all. I don't have a case to cite on that, but that is, based upon my review of the case law, that is what a ministerial function is. Now, what the Attorney General is going to argue is that, put aside the fact there is no injury or damage, they're going to argue that this was a ministerial function, even though it ultimately, as I said, doesn't matter, because essentially the word shall is in the statute. The argument is going to be is that when you're presented with this situation, you don't have any discretion at all, there's nothing to be interpreted, and you have to do this, the word shall makes it ministerial. There's a case on point saying that the word shall does not create a ministerial duty. And that is Murphy versus Bajani, 282 Georgia 197 at 199, that's a 2007 case. When Mayor Gravitt is presiding over that body, he's got to make judgment calls, snap judgment calls, based upon the things that are presented to him when they are presented to him. It is the epitome of what an official function is. Because as the Maryland court said, look at all those things he has to do at one time. It's not as simple as saying the striping on the road has to be done in a certain manner. Or it's not as simple as following, I'm trying to think of another ministerial example, of having a situation where you've not maintained your sewer pipe or something like that. Maybe in those situations, I've not researched those, but maybe in those situations, you might have an argument versus ministerial versus official function. But this is running a meeting of the governing body. And that's the height of what an official function is in the state of Georgia. To illustrate how things were presented, or what he was dealing with on the night in question, I'm going to talk about that section of the law that deals with recording of meetings. And the court's already hit on this a little bit. Because there was a change in the law that happened mere hours before this meeting took place. There was no appellate court decision on this issue. There's no Supreme Court decision on this issue. And as we all know, we don't have case history in Georgia, or excuse me, statutory history. The General Assembly doesn't provide us with that sort of stuff after they make laws. We're given the text. And so that's what we're dealing with here. Prior to April 17th, 2012, this is what the law said. Visual, comma, sound, and visual and sound recording during open meetings shall be permitted. I want to make one thing really clear right now, which is that the plaintiff in its briefs has taken this and has said shorthand that this code section says that you have to allow video recording. The word video is nowhere in there. Now, I'm not here to split hairs and say that we don't think video recording is allowed under this code provision right here. I'm not. But there's been a lot of inaccurate quotation of this code section. And that's why I'm quoting it with quotes as to what it actually says. This clearly sets up three different kinds of recording that you can do in an open meeting. The first one is visual. The second one is sound. The third one is visual and sound, a combined category. Now, this is where people would not get video from, visual and sound. But the word video is not in the old version of the Open Meetings Act, nor is it in the new version of the Open Meetings Act. So here's what Mayor Gravitt was dealing with even on the morning of April 17th, 2012. By the afternoon, this is what he was dealing with. And I have used this language, and I have shown this strike through, and the court should consider absolutely nothing but that right there, shown with the strike through. And the reason is, on April 17th, 2012, that's all we had. This is how this law passed the House. This is how this law passed the Senate. This is how this law was signed by Governor Deal. Now you have removed those words from the statute. If you go look it up right now, the court doesn't see it as it's presented here. But on the day in question, this is how it was presented. So then,
how do you see it today? I mean, you're confused.
Today, Your Honor, you would not see the strike through of sound and visual. If you look this up on Westlaw,
you would see visual and sound.
Yes,
recording.
It would say visual and sound recording of the meeting shall be permitted. But again, I'm not here to tell the court that we are denying people the ability to video in the city council chambers. In fact, and this is, I don't think Ms. Campanella is going to object to this, but the person who was trying to video that night has videoed for over a year over at City Hall, and there's not been any further incident. The city's actually adopted a policy that allows people to come in and to video. It's an official policy we have that allows people to do that. So I'm not here to say that we're not going to allow people to use video at City Hall. I only bring this up to show the court what Mayor Gravitt was dealing with, and that's why I say this is all you should look at, because this is the only thing that was available. Visual strike through of those two words and sound recording during open meeting shall be permitted. And in addition to everything else that goes on with running a meeting, this law has been changed in this regard.
Well, I know we're a plain meaning state, and I know legislative history is not applicable as a legal matter, but what in the world did the legislature change?
Well, I think that's the question the court has to wrestle with, ultimately. Here's the thing. There's also a concept in this state that the General Assembly doesn't do something for nothing. That's Holcomb versus Gray, 234 Georgia 7, is a 1975 case. They did something when they did this. And so the question is, did they do nothing? Which, in other words, means that you can still have those same three categories, visual and sound recording shall be permitted. Did they do nothing? Did they leave the statute exactly the same? I would say that runs against what Holcomb versus Gray says. Or
well, certainly they can remove redundant
modifiers. And the court may decide that that's what they did. The court may decide that's what they did in this case. Again, I'm not here today to argue that point because the city is allowing people to video record its meetings. The point that I'm here to argue is that Mayor Gravitt was presented with that. In addition to everything else he has going on, he has to read this new language and see that at least somebody could say two of the three categories have been changed, or one of the categories has been changed, or the General Assembly did nothing at all except to remove additional language. That's the point of that. The point of that is to underscore the official immunity argument, that he had this issue going on in addition to everything else that he was dealing with. I've already mentioned that the word shall does not create a ministerial duty. And there's the Holcomb versus Gray case that I mentioned earlier. Because we are dealing with official immunity, there has to be a showing of actual malice or actual intent to cause injury. And the complaint of the Attorney General alleges negligence and nothing more. That's all it says. Negligence, not one bit about actual malice or actual intent to cause injury. And without those, Mayor Gravitt enjoys official immunity. In addition to the fact that he enjoys official immunity because there's also no allegation of injury or damage. I'm actually at the end of my argument pretty much. I know the court's probably excited about that, but I'll obviously take any questions you have whenever you got them. I want to raise what I think are the Attorney General's red herrings that they have thrown out here in response to our motion to dismiss. One of them is that we are seeking to make it impossible to enforce the act. It's not what we're doing. You can still have the criminal provisions. The Supreme Court has still said there can be the mandamus to make someone do something they've not done, or prohibition to make them stop doing something.
we're dealing with here, because it's what's before the court, the civil fine. The civil action to impose a fine is what we're dealing with. We are not eviscerating the enforceability of this act by this motion in any way, shape, or form. That's the first red herring. The second red herring is the string side of cases which the plaintiff has put in multiple briefs. And I think the only thing I need to say about that is those were all decided before these 2012 amendments. They all came up before the law changed. None of them addresses this issue. None of them addresses this issue of the civil fine imposed through the suit. Not a one of them. So they're all inapplicable. In addition to that, virtually none of them raised the sovereign immunity issue. The only one that did was an issue about mandamus. The string-sided cases, although impressive, for showing that things have been done in the past on the Open Meetings Act, don't address sovereign immunity, don't address official immunity, and address an old version of the act. That's why this court's decision, as you've correctly noted, is the first time in the history of the Open Meetings Act we have ever had a civil suit to impose a fine. The Attorney General relies upon the City of Statesboro versus Dabbs. I believe that's a red herring. That's an anti-litem notice case. That was a case about attorney's fees under the Open Meetings Act. And what the Supreme Court said is that you didn't have to give anti-litem notice of that. You don't have to give anti-litem notice in a claim for attorney's fees against a municipality. It doesn't say sovereign immunity bars it. It doesn't even mention sovereign immunity. The phrase is nowhere in the case. I think what the Attorney General is saying is that anytime there's a requirement for anti-litem notice, that's when there's sovereign immunity. But if anti-litem notice is not required, then there is no sovereign immunity. That's nowhere in the Constitution. That's nowhere in the statute. Nowhere is it written that City of Cumming or any agency, department of the state, you shall have sovereign immunity unless anti-litem notice is required, and then your sovereign immunity is waived. Dabbs is a huge red herring in this case, and it doesn't deal with the issues before this court. And the final one is the broad construction issue. It is true. It's the law of this state that the Open Meetings Act is to be given a broad remedial purpose. When you're construing the Open Meetings Act, you are to construe it to give a broad remedial purpose. Justice Fletcher's provision about when in doubt, don't close, was cited multiple times. I don't know why it was cited with that quotation, because the meeting in this case wasn't closed. In fact, the city's camera was recording the entire time and has been used against us in this case. There's nothing nefarious going on about closed door politics or anything like that. It was just an issue of a recording on that one single solitary night, and that's what we're dealing with. But more importantly, the reason I say the broad construction issue is a red herring is because a broad construction issue would deal with if we were going into executive session and we were trying to decide whether or not a matter fell within the personnel exception, then if it's a close call, you don't close. Broad construction issue might be what we talked about earlier. But the court was, and I've actually forgotten what the issue was, but I said this may be a provision where you would go into a broad construction analysis. What broad construction does not mean is that you construe this law so broadly that you imply a waiver of sovereign immunity. Or you construe this law so broadly that you ignore sovereign immunity or official immunity. That's not what the broad construction means. There's actually a case which says you should not imply a waiver of sovereign immunity. And that's City of Atlanta versus Gilmere, 252 Georgia, 406. The pinpoint site is 408. It's a 1984 case. So we can't use the broad construction argument to eviscerate that which the Constitution prohibits. It's not an appropriate argument. It's a red herring in this case, because broad construction issues simply aren't at hand. You also shouldn't use, frankly, broad construction to write language into the Open Meetings Act that doesn't exist, and that goes to my statutory construction argument. The person, not the agency, especially when the General Assembly throughout the code has used, throughout the Open Meetings Act, has used those two terms very differently. In summary, the City of Cumming's defenses and those of the mayor in his official capacity are based on sovereign immunity and a lack of waiver. The statutory construction argument that by its terms, no civil fine is authorized against the City of Cumming. And then for Mayor Gravitt individually, his official immunity bars the action against him because there's no injury or damage alleged in this case, and because there's no actual malice or actual intent. Either one of those alone, under official immunity, is enough to bar this action. With that,
have you ever come across any action in Georgia or any other state where there was a claim for injury or damage related to an open sunshine or open meeting enforcement?
I'm not aware of one, although I can tell you one has been brought. The plaintiff in a Northern District of Georgia suit, Ms. Tisdale, the one who was there on the night in question, and the one upon who the Attorney General has brought this case, has sued the City of Cumming in federal court. We're in front of Judge Story right now, where she's claiming injury or damage. It's a 1983 action, but they've also included allegations that we violated the Open Meetings Act, but it's a 1983 action. I think the only other closest thing that I would tell the court is that someone tried it in that Maryland case, the one I cited earlier. The Maryland case I cited earlier, I don't remember if this was a Sunshine Law case or not, but I'll tell the court the facts of that case, and the court can take from it what it will. The Maryland case involved a man, the mayor in that case was running a meeting, as Mayor Gravitt was, and it involved a man who stood up and he wanted to ask a question. He was never recognized, and he was then restrained, and I believe he was removed from the meeting. I don't recall exactly if he was actually removed from the meeting or not, but the Maryland court said that the mayor is not liable. That's his official function. You have to show actual malice or actual intent to cause harm. I don't remember if that was an open meetings or a sunshine case where somebody was trying to allege injury or damage or not, but it's not an identical situation because, of course, we take the position, and I'll get into this later, that Ms. Tisdale was not removed from the meeting. But it's the closest thing I can think of right now, aside from the civil action in front of Judge Story, the Northern District of Georgia Gainesville Division, where we now have an action where Ms. Tisdale has brought a 1983 claim against the City of Cumming. Okay. Unless the court has any further questions for me, I'll sit down and drink some water.
I think I've exhausted you and me both. Let's take a 15-minute recess. I have, let's call it 11 o'clock. We'll start back at a quarter after.
Thank you, Mark. Thank you. Hey, Kevin Tallant, nice to meet you. We met earlier. Apparently there was a confusion over who Kevin was. Well, I'll tell you, thank you, first of all. It's very, very happy to say that. But the truth is, I use it every time. It's kind of like being a I don't know the case, so I do this. And this is how I'm learning things, is to create something like this. It's just like
PowerPoint.
Yeah, it's just like outline.
Like a
PowerPoint. Yeah, do you really? Exhausted, but we did have it. And the jury actually said that one had a difference. Anyway, Al, thank you.
prosecuting clinic, they basically gave us copies of some research talking about the various methods of folder. Some are by choice of tactile. By varying the method of presentation, keeping engaged or engaged on different types of alerts.
I think that what he's saying with the jury might be even more important than just showing the judge what you're talking about, because jurors are just people and we're living in such a electronic age.
Yeah. And to the extent that you feel like your theory of the case is a big block of letters right in front of them for minutes while you're talking.
But the thing is, you're probably about this type of problem.
Yeah, we had another PowerPoint at the faculty. I wanted to hang myself.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're just not even useful. And sometimes they're too useful. It's one of the things that I don't know.
Have you guys switched this yet? Make sure you're ready to go.
I wouldn't.
All rise. Court will come to order.
Be seated, please. Campanella, I believe. You're up.
Yes, sir. Just a couple quick preliminary points, Your Honor, and thanks again for being here and hearing us. my understanding is that there's a brief overview of the facts Mr. Tallant presented just now, and of course I have some facts that I'd like to go over as well, and intended to show the video to sort of encapsulate those facts, but I was going to wait until the motion for summary judgment to sort of keep those issues distinct, unless Your Honor would feel it beneficial to go ahead and do that now.
No, I do not. I mean, as I understand the question before the court, it's going to be in the second phase where
sure.
we have to determine whether or not issues are contested.
Correct.
I think here we're dealing with the statutory definitions, the scope of the statute itself, the sovereign immunity, the official immunity mm-hmm. issues, and none of those, as I can see, relate to a determination of whether or not they're contested facts. Okay.
Okay. So I'll hold off on that. Okay,
yeah.
Great. Mr. Tallant covered a lot of ground, and I'm going to try to address each point that he made succinctly and go through all of them, but obviously I trust your honor will stop me if he has any questions. first point I'd like to make is on the statutes that purportedly endow the city with sovereign immunity. Even assuming that sovereign immunity applies, again, Article 9, Section 2, Paragraph 9 is plainly entitled the immunity of counties, municipalities, and school districts. And it says that the General Assembly may waive the immunity of counties, municipalities, and school districts by law. There's Mr. Tallant says that the other statute, Article 2, the Article 2, Section 2, Paragraph 9, which requires specific waiver, applies. There are cases that draw a distinction between those two statutes. For example, there's a case, the City of Thompson versus Bridges, 264 GA4, that recognizes that distinction. The plain language I would also submit is a reason to examine the first provision as opposed to the latter, that as applying to the localities. To me, it seems futile for the legislature to enact a constitutional provision that is specifically entitled immunity of counties, municipalities, and school districts if another one's going to apply. That just rationally does not make sense to me. So,
well, let me do, I guess, inflict a little bit of my interruption on you as well. The statute to which the defendant referred does not, it simply says that, or to which you refer, simply says that the legislature may create a waiver of sovereign immunity. The statute to which he refers doesn't say you can't, that the legislature can't waive sovereign immunity, but it simply says that it's got to say so in the legislative act for it to be considered a waiver of sovereign immunity. So I don't take the two different discussions of the power of the legislature to be inconsistent. I just think one extends a little bit beyond the other in terms of what has to be done. So you know, that's just a thought I wanted to leave with you at this point.
Sure, Your Honor. And the point I'm going to make momentarily is that regardless of which of those you apply, we've still got it here. So,
okay.
But there are cases that recognize the distinction. The case, the Thompson case I just cited to you, recognizes that distinction and recognizes.
Tell me what distinction it recognizes. Tell me a little more about that case.
Okay. It's discussing the immunity provision. It says, since a municipality is no more than a public corporation exercising delegated authority in lieu of the state, rather than an entity exercising express authority on behalf of the state itself, the drafters of the Constitution did not consider a municipality to be a department or agency of the state subject to the sovereign immunity provisions of Article 1, Section 2, Paragraph 9, and separate constitutional provisions regarding the immunity of municipality were deemed unnecessary. So I would just argue, based on the plain language and a handful of case law that recognizes that there is indeed a distinction. But the bigger point that I'd like to make is, regardless of which you apply, even if you want to take the provision that Mr. Tallant is lying on, we've still got a waiver here. The reason for that is 4015.5, which says that the superior courts shall have jurisdiction to enforce compliance with this chapter. And the provisions of the chapter include injunctive relief, attorney's fees, civil penalties, the whole gambit. It says shall have jurisdiction to enforce compliance with this chapter. Mr. Tallant just said that sovereign immunity is a subject matter jurisdiction defense. It's a defense in which one comes to the court and says, hey, you don't have jurisdiction to hear this matter. He spent time up here trying to explain to the court that they don't believe that you all have jurisdiction in this matter. But 5014.5 in plain language has just the opposite. The General Assembly thought it through, drafted that language. It says the superior courts shall have jurisdiction. It's plain, it's unambiguous, it waives specifically, it waives generally. The court can consider these matters as based on the plain language in 5014.5. And I think that pretty succinctly addresses that whole issue. It wasn't enacted in a vacuum. I know Mr. Tallant's rebuttal is going to be, well, the statute can't do what the Constitution prohibits, but the Constitution doesn't prohibit this. The Constitution, whichever way you want to look at it, says either by law or with an express waiver, you can hear this matter. And that's precisely what 5014.5 does. So in short, I think that pretty succinctly establishes that this court is going to have the subject matter jurisdiction to hear this matter, and sovereign immunity does not apply. The jurisdictional defense of sovereign immunity. Secondly,
how do you define sovereign immunity?
Sovereign immunity is, you know,
it can be invoked by a state or a locality. For the state, it is much broader, has much bigger hoops to be jumped through than if you were a locality. But for relevant purposes here, it is established as a creature of the Constitution and also common law. But as far as what's been raised in this particular motion dismissed, we've got in front of us, we've got that one statute that we're looking at. And I would just argue that because it's a jurisdictional defense, it says to the court, sovereign immunity, you don't even get in the door, you don't have jurisdiction to hear this. 5014.5 specifically and clearly counteracts that by saying this court has jurisdiction. It makes no logical sense for the General Assembly to offer that language and then turn around and have sovereign immunity apply.
That there must be somewhere a comprehensive analysis of the definition of sovereign immunity, because we know that it does not apply in mandamus actions or actions, or I suppose any actions in equity.
That's correct.
It either doesn't apply or it's waived by the action of the municipality in contract actions.
Well, that's specifically mentioned in the Constitution.
We know that it's specifically waived in instances where the municipality has obtained collateral source payments such as insurance. We know that the Open Meeting Act or the Sunshine Law was enforceable prior to the changes in the statute on matters regarding injunctive relief, mandamus, etc. The question becomes, how do you define it when all of a sudden you create a new action which we're having difficulty defining? And that is a civil penalty. Or does the new act also create a tort right with citizens as well as the right to enforce by the Attorney General? Does it create a tort right? Does it require a tort right?
I don't think it requires, and again, there's...
Why did they say negligent?
Okay, to address Your Honor on that point, I understand where you're going with that, and you read the statute and what have you. I would argue taking a very, again, the statute has to be interpreted broadly. There's volumes of case law on that. Given the intent to promote open government and transparency, courts have routinely noted that it should be open broadly, not just in close calls. In any case that you see involving an open meetings or an open records violation, you'll see that routine quote about interpreting the act broadly. I would say here, given that mandate to interpret the act broadly and also to give full effect to the legislature's intent and to give it a rational manifestation.
But we're not an intent state, where intent is only that which is stated within the four corners of the legislation as it's drafted. So we don't know what legislative intent is. We simply decide it based on what they said. Isn't that correct?
Well, I think it turns the law a bit on its head. True, it turns the law a bit on its head to say that the negligence is the end all be all. I think more logically, it's a threshold. That's the threshold. It's irrational to say that one acts in a negligent matter and that authorizes a civil suit, but a willful action is not covered under that. I just think
why would they make it a criminal act to have a violation done willfully and wantonly, yet not allow a willful and wanton action to lead to a civil penalty and a civil enforcement action?
And respectfully, I think that's my point, Judge, is that latter interpretation doesn't really make sense given the broad scope of the act. The more likely intent of the legislature in enacting that was for the negligence to be a mere threshold. The interpretation it just would not make sense for it to be anything but a threshold, I would argue. It's the plan, to give full effect to the intent, it just doesn't make any sense, as you just noted, for there to be a criminal action based on willful actions and then only negligent actions to be encompassed by the civil. I think it was just the revision was meant to lower the threshold over which a civil suit could be brought. That was the overall logical interpretation of that wording, is how I would address that.
How would you analyze a negligent act by a mayor who has failed to enforce a provision of the sunshine law? A duty?
Are you asking me for what my example of a negligent action would be?
How would you break it out? When we go through.
I would say an example, and again, this is hypothetical, but an example of a negligent action under the open meetings law would be perhaps, noticing the meeting not within the proper window, maybe forgetting to add some things on the agenda, putting the agenda in the wrong place. That to me would be a negligent violation of the Open Meetings Act. A willful violation of the Open Meetings Act would be ejecting someone from a meeting when they've said three times, please go look at the law, I'm entitled to be here as a matter of plain statute. That would be a more willful action to me.
So we'd have to conclude that negligence is the very lowest, trigger upon which the civil action can be initiated.
That would be my interpretation.
Anything above could also result in a civil penalty, but not an additional criminal penalty unless it's charged as a misdemeanor.
That's what I would argue, Judge, yes.
Okay.
let's see, to continue on. So I believe that 5014.5, under any standard, does waive the any sovereign immunity issues that could arise. the next point I think I would make is that...
Do we really even, and again, I've got to look closely at the case you cited, but I'm going to lead you back to Professor Centel. I mean, aren't we dealing with a suit against oneself here in a legal theory? Aren't we dealing with
sure.
An enforcement action created by the legislative branch, enforced by the executive branch against a child created by the legislative branch as a separate but included agency or entity that is a city, county, or authority?
I think that's a pretty apt characterization. I think what you're leading to is my argument about sovereign immunity, whereas the state, sovereign immunity cannot be invoked by something that is a child of the state, as you say, a creation of the state, as you say. The state is the sovereign to the city of Cumming. The Cumming is not the state sovereign. So it's conceptually, it does not apply. And I think it's quite telling that for all their research and their briefing and the motion to dismiss, defendants cannot find a single case in which there it has been found to be sovereign immunity, a state or state agency initiating an action and a township invoking or attempting to invoke sovereign immunity. I think that's rather telling. And the reason is because
surely there are cases out there where where one city has sued the other for some purpose, aren't there? I mean,
Your Honor, there
if it's contractual, it's not a sovereign immunity issue. If it's if it's waived by a struggle over insured damages, it's not a sovereign immunity issue. But have you ever seen a case where there is a sovereign immunity issue where it's either a state versus a city versus an authority, a city versus a city, an authority versus an authority? Have you found any case that addresses the issue on any of those?
Your Honor, there are such cases. I think there are such cases that address that and do address it in the vein of sovereignty of the state vis-a-vis the localities. I don't have those citations with me today, but would be happy to supplement that.
And I'm gonna let you both supplement on any of the questions that I've
asked.
Because I'm just curious about how you struggle with sovereign immunity when you're essentially one agency of the same parent, at least, struggling over an enforcement issue.
Right. And, you know, conceptually, first I would argue that, you know, the state is, as I said, the state is the locality sovereign and not the other way around. And again, there's not a case out there that anyone's been able to locate stating that a locality can invoke sovereign immunity in an enforcement action against the state. It just doesn't exist. However, there is case law out there touching on the sovereignty of the state vis-a-vis localities. And again, we'd be happy to supplement on that issue for Your Honor if you'd like.
Well, I don't use localities. That's a term that I'm not familiar with.
Municipal corporation.
Right.
Okay. So I agree, it's an interesting conceptual state of affairs, but one that simply cannot exist given the common law and given the existing separation of powers. I would submit that's something that conceptually does not make sense. It cannot stand for a municipality to invoke sovereign immunity vis-a-vis the state. So I think that's a good point.
What if this action, clearly it's authorized, what if Ms. Tisdale had filed this action instead of the Attorney General?
Well, she has.
What if she had? Would there then be, would sovereign immunity then creep out of the woodwork and become...
Well, I'm not fully up to speed on Ms. Tisdale's separate federal suit, but I do believe that...
I don't mean federal suit, I mean in this court.
Well, in that suit, they also asserted an open meetings claim as well, I believe. If you have a private citizen suing a locality, I think there are a number of reasons that suit would go forward and that sovereign immunity would not apply. But the particular principle we've just been talking about, that wouldn't apply.
But you would have to admit that the city would have a stronger argument in a case brought by an individual than they do in a case brought for enforcement by another agency of the state.
I think that's right. I think they would still be equipped with, as I think the plaintiff in that case would still be equipped with a number of arguments to attack sovereign immunity, but they do not have that particular argument we just made. That's right.
Okay.
That's absolutely right, Judge.
All right.
and another point I'd make is sort of reaches out to the string site, as Mr. Tallant put it, of cases. Those cases are not a red herring. They're very important because they show that for years and years and years, courts have had no problem enforcing 50.14.5. which prescribes for injunctive relief, declaratory relief, as well as attorney's fees. Courts and litigants have had no problem enforcing an open meetings or Open Record Act claims against localities and states without sovereign immunity being an issue. And crucially, Mr. Tallant admitted that they don't have a problem with that in this case either. And indeed, on page 13 of their response to our motion for summary judgment, they say that they do not challenge the ability of this office to enforce the Open Meetings Act through injunction, mandamus, prohibition, or declaratory judgment, all of which are authorized by 50.14.5. That's very crucial because that means we don't end here. That means at least on that minimum remedy that we seek, attorney's fees and injunctive relief, which we certainly do seek here, based on that admission, we've got to go forward to hear summary judgment. Just based on that admission alone, they've gone ahead and conceded, yes, indeed, we do have the right to proceed with at least the remedies prescribed in 50.14.5. So, you know, they've got no problem with that. There is no sovereign immunity issue there. So I think my point on that is that we can close the book on that and move forward with at least those claims and just address the civil enforcement provision that has been sort of keyed in as the issue here. Going back to those cases, again, there was never a litigant or a judge who had an issue enforcing the action based on sovereign immunity or any other principle. And they've conceded that's fine. Mr. Tallant also mentioned that he thought that the criminal provision might also be enforceable and sovereign immunity wouldn't be a problem. So I'm curious what the difference is about a civil enforcement penalty that all of a sudden makes this new and magic and different and suddenly subject to sovereign immunity. I'd argue that
let me try to hit you with my problem in that regard. I think we're all on the same page when it comes to, and I hate to go back to archaic terms, but we have to because it's still relevant our law, but if you're in the equity court, everything continues to go with no question, without the issue of sovereign immunity. That would include mandamus, prohibition, whatever that is, declaratory judgment, injunctive relief, etc. Which was up until, as I understand the history on this matter, up until April 17, when this event occurred and when the governor made effective the new legislation, was the only court in which the Sunshine Law was enforceable, in the Superior Court, in its branch called the Court of Equity. Is that correct?
At that time, the criminal and the injunctive relief, as well as the attorney's fees in 50.14.5. Yes, that was the only relief that could be sought.
All that existed,
sure.
And it was all done over here in what they used to teach in law school as the Court of Equity. All of a sudden, on April 17th, either purposefully or accidentally, the legislature created at least a question. And that is whether or not now we're creating a new remedy which extends to citizens or to the enforcement arm of the Attorney General. And we're going to use terminology that's more related to actions at law, which is this court over here. It doesn't say damages outright, but it almost implies it. It does say negligent conduct outright, which belongs over here. Many questions arise out of that. One, whether or not now sovereign immunity is an issue where it was not over here. But even a larger issue, how do we try a dispute of fact in this case, if all of a sudden it's in this court, which is a court of law? Is there an automatic right to a jury trial? Where do we go from here? I mean, there are so many headaches attached here that are not answered by me or you that concern me.
Sure. My response to that would be a couple of things. One is that a court of equity can also sit as a court of law. It can be the same thing simultaneously.
Yeah, but
so
you have to apply different rules, although you can sit as the same thing.
Right. Civil, sure, there are certain rules that apply to civil actions that don't apply to equitable actions, but I believe a court can sit as a court of equity and a court of law simultaneously
without...
You have
to separate them. If you're going to rule on factional disputes as a court of equity, you can do it just like we are right here. But if there are issues raised on the court of law side, and one party says, I want a jury, they've got to have a jury.
I'm not sure I really...
And in Georgia, it's a 12-person jury, not a 6-person jury.
Sure, I think there are different issues, but I don't know that sovereign immunity is the...
No, I'm not talking about sovereign immunity. I've gone beyond that. Okay. I'm talking about where we go next.
Okay.
How do you define a civil penalty? Is it damages?
No, it's not damages. This is an enforcement action. It's a distinct creature of statute. It can be heard in a court of equity or a court of law. It's an enforcement action. It's a distinct statutorily created animal. It can be brought, you know, strictly to enforce this statute.
Let's go back to a similar situation which existed at least for a while in federal law, and that is the Clean Air or the Clean Water Act, which created an enforcement action to be undertaken by the Department of Justice, and then threw in what turned out to be extremely problematic, and that was a civil action right by any citizen who may feel that they have been offended by a violation of the Clean Water or Clean Air Act. And all of a sudden you had all kinds of lawsuits brought under the extended authority of that action. It almost looks to me like the legislature has ventured into that territory. Is that what they've done? They've created a new expanded right for a tort civil action based on the duty created by the Open Meeting Act.
I don't think it's a tort.
Why do they use the word negligently if it's not a tort?
Because it's simply the threshold for judging the conduct. It's not seeking any sort of the state is not seeking damages to make itself whole. It's a penalty. It's a more punitive.
If Ms. Tisdale had brought it instead of the state, could she seek nominal damages or even real damages?
I believe she is.
In the federal act.
Correct. But and this
then there's no question that it's a damage suit or a tort.
Well, it's different though, because I believe her claims are couched specifically as such, battery claims, things of that nature. This is not that. This is an enforcement action which seeks to, one sense, it's a remedial measure. In another sense, it seeks to hold governments accountable and seeks to prevent future violations of the law by having this additional remedy hanging over governments who may want to violate, hanging over their head. It's an enforcement action brought by a state agency who's been specifically tasked by the legislature to have this police power over governments who do not maintain open meetings or open records properly. It's its own specific statutorily authorized beast, 5014.
Could it have been meant though to single out that one hard-headed person who keeps right on closing the door in spite of the fact that the law clearly says he or she should not do so? And could it be restricted to that person as opposed to punishing the taxpayers of the entire municipality? Could it intend very clearly to address the conduct of the person who either is so carefree and negligent that he or she doesn't learn the law and apply the law, or is so bullheaded that they continue to violate the law? I mean, could that be a legitimate reason for identifying a person as opposed to an agency as being subject to a penalty?
I think person, the term was used simply to encompass both natural persons and entities.
Well, that's a general proposition, but when you use both agency and person in the same legislative act, you're creating something other than a general application of the term, aren't you?
Yes, but...
And again, I'm not arguing with
you. Oh, sure. No, I understand.
I'm simply telling you where I run into points of confusion.
Sure. That's you're here to ask me questions, and I'm here to give you answers. Sure. Sure, I can understand that. I just think that taking, again, a rational approach to the purposes behind the law, a rational approach to the language that exists in the law, person has got to mean natural person and entity all combined into one. If the legislature really wanted to limit it, they could have used the word natural person. Again, we've got the Citizen United case.
We're talking only about the criminal provision, the paragraph above the one we're struggling on.
And again, Mr. Tallant has said they have no problem with that. That's unfortunate.
Well, I know, but I do. And my problem is this. Let's say we really are angry at the City of Cumming, and we want to charge them with a misdemeanor. And I guess if you define misdemeanor, not only do you have the right to fine them, but you have the right to confine them for up to 12 months, typically. And let's say that we brought this action as a criminal action through the magistrate's court against the city under the criminal provision. Is that going to fly?
What, a criminal action? I mean, speaking hypothetically, since that's not an issue here, but speaking hypothetically, I think it's authorized. It's been the law for years. There's never been any reason to believe it would not.
Do you have any actions where a misdemeanor charge has been brought against a county, a city, or an authority?
There have been some, and I don't know that any resolution was ever reached on that particular question.
Try to find me some of those too in your supplemental brief. Excuse me.
Sure. So you're just curious as to whether there's been any criminal cases and.
Well, I'm not just curious. I'm looking for help.
Okay. Sure. Turning back to some of the points I wanted to make. I think it's axiomatic whether it's an equitable suit that the Attorney General is bringing, civil suit or criminal suit, what have you. It's important to note that sovereign immunity hasn't been raised in any of the cases to this date. And I think the reason is because, it's its own special beast. It's directed specifically at government entities, agencies, and officials, and only these entities, because it has a specific intent of holding them accountable for their actions when conducting government actions. So to me, it makes no sense the General Assembly would enact the Open Governments Law to have it held hostage to the whims of those people that it seeks to enforce the law against, to be held hostage by the alleged violators. In other words, they can only choose to waive the purportedly omnipresent sovereign immunity and be subject to the action whenever they see fit. To me, that's one of the more practical and rational policy reasons why sovereign immunity just can't apply here. You don't have an action where the alleged violators are at the helm calling the shots as to when they can have sovereign immunity and when they can't. If that were the case, the law would be operating completely futile. All the General Assembly's work in drafting not only the civil provision, but all the other provisions would be completely futile, and that just can't be the case. That's not the point of this law. That's not why the General Assembly passed it. So I submit that for Your Honor's consideration as a practical matter as well. let's see, I think that covers most of the points. Turning to the personhood issue, which we've briefly sort of touched on, again, I note, regardless of the interpretation of the person issue, I would submit that regardless of whether the city is a person, person has got to apply to the mayor under the plain reading of the law. He's a natural, he's both a natural citizen, he's a person. It could be, to me, that remedy's got to apply at least there, no matter how you come down on whether it applies to an agency, although our position is it applies to both. again, there are two different things going on here. There's an official suit, there's a suit against the mayor's official capacity, and there's a suit in the personal capacity. The official capacity suit, the same sovereign immunity argument is being used in that capacity as was with the city. And there's a specific case, which is IBM versus General Administrative Services. It's in our brief, and I can certainly get the citation for you when I sit back down. But that case specifically holds that you can hold an official who oversteps his bounds in a governmental capacity, you can hold them, you can have an injunction action against them when they, under color of office, they make certain actions, they can be enjoined from future violations. So we've got no sovereign immunity in that particular instance. The mayor can be enjoined in his official capacity, and sovereign immunity doesn't apply. IBM says that. In the personal capacity.
But that was never an issue, because we all know that the sovereign immunity doesn't relate to the equitable court over here. I mean, aren't we?
That's a good point. So for those, that's double reasons why it applies to Mayor Gravitt. Not just the reason I just stated, but the reason that Your Honor has also noted. So there's two good reasons why that doesn't apply to Mayor Gravitt. As far as the personal capacity, that is where official immunity that Mr. Tallant discussed up here at length for a while, that's where that official immunity comes in. And that, again, exists for all the reasons that he discussed. When people got a lot going on and they need to make a call and use their discretion, that's there to protect them. That's not what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a willful, clear, undisputable action that was a refusal to perform a ministerial duty. There's, for years, not just on April 17th, 2012, but for years, the law has been in existence. It's been clear that video or record, any type of recording is allowed, and there's been recordings allowed there as well. I could bring up. It's what I call much ado about a strike through. It's quite evident to me, and the rational interpretation is that they're, just as Your Honor noted, eliminating redundancies. It seems rather illogical to suppose that this strike-through would suggest that just visual or just sound recording is possible, but not both simultaneously. And to that end, I would be curious how the mayor knew that Ms. Tisdale was, in fact, doing both simultaneously when she was asked to shut her camera down. So my point on official immunity is it just doesn't apply here, because we've got the fiction of the mayor stepping out of his official capacity into a non-governmental role because he stepped outside the bounds of his governmental authority. He refused to perform a ministerial act. This was not the mayor up at the helm deciding whether or not to approve a contract, something to that effect that really involves discretion. This was him simply refusing to allow someone to be a part of the meeting and record the meeting when it was made evident repeatedly that this was a violation of the law. So official immunity just doesn't apply here because it was a refusal to perform a ministerial duty and not some sort of act of discretion that warrants official immunity. So that was how I would address that. I think that's my rebuttal to everything, except just to reiterate that it's been a hallmark of every open meetings case that's ever come before any court that the law's got to be interpreted broadly. And that canon of interpretation is not a red herring. Defendant suggested earlier, it's been mentioned in every case. It's mentioned not just in close cases, And the policy, to the point about the closed government not being an issue here, it not being a part of the policy that is intended to promote transparency and prevent against closed door government, that policy is instituted only after this incident. So I would submit that the broad construction and the policies behind the hack are every bit as relevant in this case as they would be in any case, if not more so, given the very straightforward and undisputable nature of the actions. And I think that may be all I have on the motion for summary judgment issue.
Pardon me? Motion to dismiss.
I'm sorry, the motion to dismiss issues, unless Your Honor has any more questions.
Are there other cases, enforcement cases, handled by your office that are currently in litigation or in the process of appeal?
No, Your Honor, you're not. And to be quite honest, there are very few that ever have to be brought because most litigants will try to resolve this with us short of a lawsuit, and that was not possible here.
Right. What I'm going to do is take a lunch break and then address the summary judgment issues. But before we do that, let me do a little housekeeping of my own. Have there been any issues to resolve this case by compromise?
Absolutely. For 2 months following the incident, there was an extended dialogue.
Well, why don't you stand up and come up here too, Mr. Town? Let's talk in terms of what is your assertions insofar as evidence to compromise this case?
Well, I don't think the defendants can dispute it, but there were the office handled as they do any allegation of a complaint, a letter asking for an explanation. And, it was attempted to be resolved.
Your Honor, if Mr. Miles and I can address the court, I'm Stefan.
Sure, I'll let you all go wild on this.
Okay. Before Mr. Tallant and Ms. Campanella were involved in this case, I think that Mr. Miles and I are both the superiors of our relative people who are speaking today, and we spent some time trying to resolve this case. And we had a very cordial relationship in trying to do that. I won't go into all the details. I will tell you, unless there's any problem with that, that I think that the sticking point was that the Attorney General wanted an admission of violation of the law in this case, and the other side was not willing to agree to that. And I think the reason is because they were concerned about that being an admission against interest in future cases, and certainly they vigorously contest liability. So that's where we are on settlement. I'm not going to discuss settlement with the court, but I want you to know that that's the situation, and I think that if we could agree that it was not useful in any other, usable in any other proceeding as an admission of liability, we probably would have been able to come to a resolution.
I would concur with what Mr. Ritter said. The sticking point was the Attorney General, not Mr. Ritter, but his boss, insisted upon an admission of liability by the city. My fear was that that would be used against the city in a lawsuit by Ms. Tisdale. She hadn't filed the suit at that point in time. The Attorney General's office opinion was that she didn't have the right at that time to file that suit. She filed it anyway. We currently have pending against us exactly what I predicted would happen. That's why we were not successful in resolution. The other matters I think we could work through and did work through fairly successfully, but the sticking point was it requested an admission of liability, and the city was unwilling to do that, and therefore, because of potential for collateral
third
party suits.
Is there a distinction between an admission of fact versus an admission of liability?
There could be, Your Honor, but in this particular case, discussion as I understood it was they wanted an admission that the city and Mayor Gravitt had violated the Open Meetings Act. And so if you admit to those facts, that in essence is an admission of liability.
Well, that's exactly where we're headed with the motion for summary judgment that's filed by the Attorney General, if as I understand it, upon any of the three allegations, there is an undisputed allegation of factual sequence which constitutes a violation, then this court is going to have to rule that there was, in fact, at least a violation. So what are you doing if you're admitting, if you're going into this afternoon's session without a defense on any of one of the three different avenues of violation, why not go ahead and settle the case and let the federal court deal with all these issues of sovereign immunity instead of
Your Honor?
Instead of me having to do it with. I mean, we're not talking about mountains of gold here.
That's right.
We're talking about doing what council tells me the city's already doing, and that is having a carefully defined, well thought out regulation by which any citizen can be safe in a meeting with recording devices or video cameras or anything else. And we already do that, I'm told.
I'm told that's the case too, and that being the case, we're delighted to see that came out of these negotiations and ultimately lawsuit. And we, you know, frankly, from our perspective, our feet were sort of put to the fire. They called us and said, why don't you file a lawsuit because we're not going to admit the liability. I'll tell you, Your Honor, I don't want to get into the summary judgment issues, but they acknowledged this morning that no one disputes that she was ordered to stop reporting. We see the text right there. And, you know,
that's
not mountain.
Let me leave y'all with something to talk about at lunch. I've read almost everything, I think, that's been provided in this case. Now, I have not seen the movie, but I don't think the movie adds anything to the lack of evidence on the city side. It looks very clearly to me at this point like there is no dispute over the fact that the citizen's right to record and to take video within the meeting was violated. And there has been no reason given, which is your responsibility on summary judgment response. There's been no reason given which constitutes a defense to that violation. I mean, the others are very clearly, at least at this stage of my knowledge, disputed facts. You know, I don't know whether she left the room or didn't. I don't know whether she was thrown out or wasn't. I don't know whether she was, it's disputed even that she was told by the mayor or by anyone with real authority to stop the second recording session. But if we admit that she was stopped her effort to record, and there was no excuse of disruption or interference with sight line or noise or anything else, and it hasn't been asserted, aren't we already in a state where we've admitted liability on one point of the complaint? Think about it. We'll talk about it this afternoon. Y'all talk. Eat lunch together.
Yes, sir.
Be in recess until 10 minutes after 1.
Thank you, Your Honor. I don't know what to say.
Well, No handshake from the mayor. He didn't want to check.
I'm sorry if I misread
that. That's okay. Yeah, we just saw the.
Okay. Okay, I'll clarify that one. I'm sorry if I misread that. Just sort of trying to
roll. Yes, good job.
Supplemental briefs, and that the court would delay ruling on both motions until such time had elapsed. This would allow both of us to see if we could work out something with our clients that we could submit to the court. And if we are unsuccessful in that by August the 9th, which is approximately 2 weeks from today, then we would then take the time to do the supplemental briefs on the items that the court has brought to our attention. And then you would obviously consider the case after those supplemental briefs would be submitted. And that would be, I think, in general, what we discussed. I'll allow him to add to that.
I'm fine with that. I did discuss the dates of the supplemental briefs. Those dates are fine. 23rd is probably preferable for me, but sure. Whatever suits the court and its direction.
Was it the 23rd or the 27th? 30th?
Well, the 23rd is a Friday. I was trying to get to the end of a week. The 9th is 2 weeks from tomorrow, and that was given us 2 weeks.
I would just say the 30th of August for supplemental.
Okay.
And there's one reason I would beg the time. I'm supposed to leave Sunday to go on a wonderful beach trip to Panama City with my grandchildren, their in-laws, and a whole host of other people.
Oh, that's great.
So I'll be out of circuit for at least a week. Let me ask you this: do you think you can make the same progress just between the two of you as you would with a mediator? Or I mean, do you want me to order mediation, or do you want me just to leave it between the two of you?
I'm not asking for mediation. I don't oppose it, and I'm happy to follow the court's direction. I will say that Mr. Miles and I have worked very well together, I think, so I don't think that issue about communication is a problem.
Okay.
It's always an interest to having the clients coaxed a little bit, but that's to where it goes.
Well, I'm a firm believer that mediation or some form of mediation, we have what we call judicial settlement conference, which I guess you do have here as well.
Yes, sir.
And to me, those problems have emerged as much more important today than they were 10 years ago.
Certainly.
Because litigation is so expensive and so, our system requires so much time and so much effort that settlement is an important alternative. And I can see how it's important in this case. Very important in this case.
I think from the city's perspective, we would request that perhaps Mr. Ritter and I have an opportunity to talk, and if we feel that mediation, either side feels that mediation would be appropriate, then, and for instance, if he requests it, I'll agree to it, and if he, and vice versa, I think if we can, we'll know within a week or so whether mediation would be helpful in the case, and if we need further direction, we'll contact the court in that regard. We did feel like it was important for Mr. Tallant and Ms. Campanella to briefly argue the MSJ while you're here, and for you to hear those arguments.
Absolutely.
But we wanted to make this announcement to the court because you'd asked us about it right before lunch, and we wanted to report back to you as soon as we got back from lunch.
Good, very good. That sounds like progress to me, and I will agree to what you propose. I will not rule on any issue or partial issue until after August the 9th. I will expect you to notify me either on or before August the 9th as to the progress that you've made in settlement. I will leave open the supplemental briefs by either party until the 30th of August, after which time I will rule both on the motion to dismiss and the summary judgment all at the same time.
Fair enough.
Thank you, Your Honor.
You're the movement, Michelle.
Yeah, very well. Just so I'm clear, I'm up here once. Am I coming back? Just coming up once. Mr. Tallant's going to come up.
Go ahead.
We're going to clear the slate and start the motion for summary judgment.
Okay, so I'll address everything at once.
What normally I would do is give you the opportunity to address your summary judgment motion. And then give him the response, and then if there's any necessity of rebuttal, I'll allow you that. But let me go back to where I was just before lunch. Unless someone shows me otherwise, it appears from the record, and I've had the complete record before me, including your briefs, your response, your affidavits, etc. It appears to me that there are going to be questions of fact regarding the issue of ejection from the room. There are probably questions of fact regarding the second recording event. And it may be, one issue may be whether or not she was in fact stopped and interrupted. Another issue may be whether or not in fact she was stopped and interrupted at the mayor's direction or under his authority. But I do not see, and I beg either party to show me, that there is a question of fact regarding the issue of whether or not Ms. Tisdale was made to stop recording in both the video and the sound in the first event. So I guess what I'm saying to you, if y'all want to talk about that one issue alone, that's pretty much where I'm going to be. It's probably going to take an evidentiary hearing to resolve those other two issues. I've read the affidavits on both parties. As I understand my authority as a judge on summary judgment, I take everything you tell me in an affidavit as the truth. And if they're opposing truths, then somebody has to weigh the credibility and weight through testimony, and I'm not going to do that today. Okay?
All right, understood, Judge. Thanks very much. And I'm going to hope to nudge you a little bit in those last two. I do understand your position on the first. With your indulgence, since I'm going to be referring to it a fair amount over the next couple of minutes as part of the record evidence, I'd like to show the video recording that Ms. Tisdale took that day. It's been authenticated through her affidavit and is part of the record. So.
Okay.
It's only about a minute and a half or so to be shown.
Do you need me to try to record what's being said?
Yeah, I think that'd be helpful.
If you can't. I don't know who the speakers are. Or anything, so.
No.
I might have all the kids for you to talk about.
Oh.
Go all the way to the bottom, click.
This time I'm being noticed to park the record every month to the April meeting of Cumming City Council. First of all, I love house cleaning. Chief Tatum, if you would remove the camera from the auditorium. We don't allow film inside of the city hall again. That's just specific reasons. So if you would remove the camera. That's the reason we don't have a Comcast up here on the wall.
Respectfully, Mayor, Georgia, I'm so sorry. No, sir. Georgia, well, I'm exercising my right as a citizen to record this meeting. Sir, this is an open and public meeting. I have a right to Georgia when I record this meeting at State of Adams, at State Council, at State Miles. Right by Georgia law, there will be a complaint filed with Georgia Attorney General not allowing me to film this meeting. Take your hands off of me. Take your hands off of me, sir. Let me get my hands back in, sir. You were violating Georgia state law, which. This is illegal. You cannot close a meeting. I have a right by Georgia law, and you should consult your counsel, Dana Miles. He is aware of Georgia state law.
Come on. I'll
turn it on.
There are two very clear and unambiguous provisions of the Georgia Open Meetings Act that are going to bear out these three pretty transparent violations. The first is 5014B1, which provides that given the definition of meetings provided in the act, and all sides agree that the incident occurred during one, all meetings shall be open to the public. 5014.1C provides that the public shall be afforded access to meetings declared open to the public pursuant to subsection B of this code section. Visual and sound recording during the open meeting shall be permitted. The first incident I'll go through very quickly because I think we've all sort of understood there's a violation there, but it's undisputable and defendants have freely admitted that this command not to record occurred. It's on the video. Defendants themselves have admitted it in response to statement of material fact number 17 and 18. They've admitted it in their brief in response to our motion for summary judgment, saying that defendants acknowledge that Ms. Tisdale's camera was removed from where she set it up and she was instructed not to record the meeting. So I think, as Your Honor has noted, that's sort of a foregone conclusion. We're in agreement that it's undisputed that she was asked not to record at the outset of the meeting. That plainly violates the provision I read about members of the public being able to record at the meeting. The second violation cannot be disputed. That Ms. Tisdale was repeatedly asked to leave during the course of the meeting. We just heard on the video, and if necessary, we can play it back. But the gentleman you hear talking to her there in the foreground, that's Chief Tatum, of the Chief of Police of Cumming. And he is telling her, not once, not twice, not three times, but four times, step outside, ma'am, step outside, step outside. He's fully uniformed, acting as authority on behalf of the City of Cumming, telling this resident, I'm sorry, this citizen following the meeting, step outside. I would argue that under the act that says meetings shall be open to the public, this plain and unambiguous statute has got to be read very broadly given the intent of the act. Telling someone as a fully uniformed officer that they're going to have to step outside four times, that to me is removable under the Open Meetings Act. Moreover, you'll note that as the camera lens turns up, he says, come on, it's finished, go file your complaint. That to me is further record evidence that this was a removal for purposes of the statute. I'd like to make a distinction because I know, excuse me, the defendants are going to come up here and try to manufacture certain factual quibbles about who touched who, what was there any touching, what did she do afterwards. Judge, the important thing to remember is that on a motion for summary judgment, we are looking at whether there's a genuine issue of material fact. Those are not material facts. Who touched who doesn't matter. This is not a battery claim that's requiring technical proof of contact. This is an open meetings claim, and we're here to decide whether or not this person was allowed to have a, whether the meeting was indeed open to the public. I'd argue having your chief of police come up to her repeatedly, wrap her arms around the tripod, and I'd like to show this demonstrative exhibit if I could, which depicts the incident, and Mr. Tallant has already stipulated to its authenticity. Stefan, would you mind? I would argue, Your Honor, that this is removable for purposes of the statute. To have a uniformed officer come and lift the camera with a woman standing around it and tell her repeatedly to step outside, that's all the material facts we need here. It doesn't matter what she did afterwards. Her conduct is not the subject of this open meetings claim. It's the conduct of the City of Cumming and its officers. So I'd argue it's undisputed as a matter of law. All the material facts support this, the fact that Ms. Tisdale was, in fact, removed for purposes of the law, and the meeting was not open to her on that day. Third, and this is also undisputed, I would argue, about 33 minutes into the meeting, and this is on the city's video, of course, because her camera had been shut down at that point, it's shown that the deputy chief of police, Deputy Cook, leans over to her, Ms. Tisdale sitting in the front row, leans over to her and whispers something. We don't know what that is, although Ms. Tisdale said in her affidavit, defendants have not disputed, that what he told her was to stop recording. In fact, in response to our motion for summary judgment, on page 5 of the response, defendants state, after observing her for some time, Chief Cook leaned forward and reminded her that Mayor Gravitt asked her not to record. They then cite to Cook's affidavit in support of that. Leaning over and asking someone not to record as a reminder, that's what the mayor said. Your Honor, I respectfully submit that that's in violation of the provision allowing individuals to record meetings. Telling someone to record, whether or not they actually listen to you and surreptitiously do it, that's a violation. It's what the Open Meetings Act was intended to protect. It's construed broadly, it wants transparent government. It shouldn't matter whether he politely asked her, reminded her. The law is not concerned with those semantics. The law wants people to be able to comfortably record meetings without fear that a police officer will come and tell them to stop, whether that's a reminder or not. So I would state that it's undisputed and all the material facts support that there was a third violation about 30 minutes into the meeting when Ms. Tisdale was asked not to record a second time with her camera, with her handheld camera with sound clips. I think that any of the factual issues that I anticipate defendants are going to come up here and try to raise with you, those are all, again, immaterial to our legal claims. another thing that I sort of would like to caution the court about is they may come up and insinuate that they need more discovery in this matter. That will solve everything. Again, the relevant point here is that as all essential claims of each of our three counts, we've got all we need in the video and in Ms. Tisdale's affidavit saying that supporting our material facts. That's we've got everything in place as it is. None of the depositions they could take of the police officers, We could sit here all day long and take depositions of police officers and each and every person in that room that day as to who touched who, or you know, what she did afterwards, or who she talked to when she left the meeting. None of that matters. The focus here is on the conduct of the government actors and the things that they did during the meeting, and the things that they said. No deposition is going to change the fact that she was told four times, to step outside, or that she was told not once but twice to stop recording. So I would submit that as extra discovery, it's just really going to, again, draw out this litigation and draw out the resources of the state government, the local government, and your honor. So I would just argue that more government is not necessary, not really a solution at this point to summary judgment. And I think that's about all I have.
Let me look at my notes before I let you sit down and make sure that I'm not forgetting something that I had written down.
Your Honor, I want to hit on a couple of things first, because I didn't do a rebuttal to our motion to dismiss. Before I turn to the factual issues, I did want to tell you we found a case for you. The case is Upper Oconee Basin Water Authority versus Jackson County, 305 Georgia App 409. That's a 2011 case. And in that case, you had two government entities going at each other.
They're going. Strangely enough, I think I'm scheduled to mediate the reemergence of that case.
Well, Judge Booth decided it, so you may very well be. But Judge Booth decided that, and one of the entities, and I apologize to the court, I don't recall which, raised the issue of sovereign immunity, and said this other government entity cannot bring a claim against us. We have sovereign immunity from that claim. Judge Booth analyzed the claim of sovereign immunity. He went into it. He ultimately found a waiver of sovereign immunity. So in other words, Judge Booth recognized in that case that there is sovereign immunity when one arm of the government sues another arm of the government. He just found a waiver of the sovereign immunity in that case.
Waiver based on
contract. It was a contract waiver.
There's no question though that the contract waiver is widely known, but that's not what we're dealing with here.
It's not, but the court's overall question was, in the scheme of things, does sovereign immunity apply when one governmental entity is against another governmental entity? And the answer to that question is
yes,
it does. But it was waived in that particular case that Judge Booth decided back in 2011. I did want to hit on a couple of other things. I guess at the end of the day, the thing I'll get to in the sovereign immunity argument and what Ms. Campanella was arguing about is, are we really going to, you know, why would the General Assembly go to all this trouble? Why would the General Assembly do all this if at the end of the day it's all for naught because they can't waive the sovereign immunity of local governments? Why would they go through all the trouble of enacting these statutes if at the end of the day it's completely ineffective? That misses the entire point of our arguments. It's not that the General Assembly can't waive sovereign immunity. It's that they didn't do it properly. They didn't have the specific waiver that's called for by the code, by the Constitution, by the case law. It's not that they can't waive sovereign immunity. Official immunity, I submit to this court, they cannot waive. The General Assembly cannot. The official immunity provision says this paragraph shall not be waived. Sovereign immunity can be waived, but the General Assembly did not go about it the wrong way. That's not the City of Cumming's fault. That's not the Attorney General's office's fault. The General Assembly did not go about it as they are required to go about it. And I'll say this on the issue of sovereign immunity, the case, the 1983 case, and the year 1983 is what I'm talking about, of the City of Thomaston case was cited to the court as being the provision that says that the Article 1 provision of sovereign immunity, I think it's Article 1, no longer applies to cities. That's the case that I was talking about where the Supreme Court was going back and forth so much over what sovereign immunity applied where. That case was decided in 1983. Don't lose fact of the sight that in 2004, in the CSX Transportation Inc. versus Garden City of Georgia case, the Supreme Court said you have to have a specific waiver of sovereign immunity to waive a city government sovereign immunity. I can't argue with what's on the books in 1983. What I can argue is that in 2004, the Supreme Court of this state said it takes a specific waiver to waive the sovereign immunity of a city government. I'm going to turn now briefly to the motion for summary judgment. Your Honor, here is what is agreed upon. Now, I cannot argue with what the court heard on the video in terms of what was said. I'm not going to stand up here and tell the court this wasn't said. It would be futile, and you would get very angry at me if I told you something wasn't said when it was on the video. What's agreed upon is that Mayor Gravitt called for the camera to be removed. I can't argue any differently. He asked Chief Tatum to do that. It's on the video. The camera was then moved to the side and the rear where Ms. Tisdale agreed to stop recording. You heard in the video. She said, okay, I'll turn it off. Ms. Tisdale was later reminded, Chief Cook's affidavit says that he reminded that Mayor Gravitt asked her to not record. The mayor did not direct Chief Cook to do that. Deputy Chief Cook. Deputy Chief Cook simply did this, leaned forward and reminded her the mayor asked for her to not record. Deputy Chief Cook, he could have just made up his own story about what was said. He could have, come up with something different than what Ms. Tisdale did, but he told the truth, and he said in his affidavit, I reminded her the mayor asked for her not to record.
Let me interrupt you there and give you an impression of the court, and that is that rather than arguing all of the events that occurred thereafter, if you look at the mayor's announcement from the bench, so to speak, at the very beginning, it clearly gave directions to Ms. Tisdale, to the chief, to the sergeant at arms, to anybody else within that council room, that the City of Cumming does not allow recording unless it's authorized for a specific reason. Isn't that all that needs to be said? Well, isn't that the whole case as far as exclusion for recording is concerned?
Well, it's certainly not the whole case, and I'm going to get into it.
In regard to the first and third event.
I would say not for the third event. I think for the third event, Chief Cook leaned up, and Chief Cook is the one who made the statement. So,
what he's saying, though, is that guy Young was in charge, and that guy said, hey, we're not going to do any recording in this room?
That's correct. The point I'm making is, I'm not sure what the Attorney General's purpose in that is. If they are seeking to have Mayor Gravitt be liable for an additional fine, assuming
the only effect is that it's a second event, whether or not it's really, whether or not it's a second event is a matter of construction. The event was the mayor saying we're not going to allow any recording, period.
I think from a factual standpoint, you've got the facts, yes. Okay. The legal issues, what was the law, how the law was changed, the myriad issues that we have raised in this case about sovereign immunity and official immunity, you've got a lot of different issues to deal with. I mean, at the end of the day, the question really becomes, what are you going to be left to decide? I've submitted to you already that we do not believe that injunctive relief is right here because there's not been an evidentiary hearing. We believe we're entitled to an evidentiary hearing on the issue of injunctive relief. And I've mentioned to you already that we believe that we're going to be in a position to move for summary judgment on that issue. Ms. Campanella mentioned something about how the city's going to stand up here and say additional discovery is necessary. I absolutely am going to say additional discovery is necessary on the issue of injunctive relief. That's critical for us. As an illustration of why additional discovery is necessary, 2 days ago, I was served with 6 audio recordings, I think 4 of which, at least 3 of which, I didn't even know existed, dealing with this suit, recording different events, different conversations that I had no idea existed. I got them for the first time. 2 of them I haven't even had time to listen to yet. So I do think that additional discovery is necessary because additional facts, more than a year into this case, are still coming out in response to the discovery request we propounded probably 9-10 months ago. So on the issue of injunctive relief, and here's why I'm saying that, Judge. On the issue of injunctive relief, if you find that sovereign immunity and official immunity bars the claim, and then we are allowed to do what we want to do on the injunctive relief, there's no more case for you to decide. Because we believe the injunctive relief, and I think Ms. Campanella acknowledged it, the city's allowing recording. We don't have subsequent violations going on. The city's allowing people to record. The injunctive relief issue is moot. And then the sovereign immunity, official immunity issues, those bar the suit completely. One claim is gone for mootness. The other claims are barred by the immunity doctrines. There's nothing more for you to decide, is where I'm going with this. On the facts, you've got the facts as to, as you called it, the first alleged violation. But the legal issues don't mean that you just automatically say, City of Cumming, you violated. There are other steps that have to take place first. On to the issues that are in dispute. Ms. Tisdale claims under oath, and this is what was in the Attorney General's complaint, to have been forcibly removed from the City Hall auditorium. Not removed from the meeting, not, and I think that's a distinction without a difference, frankly. But none of this allegation that, well, this is kind of a removal and that's what this is all getting at. No, swore under oath that she was forcibly removed from the City Hall auditorium. And the court's already found it, or you already recognize it, there are 4 affidavits of individuals who affirmed this never happened, and that Ms. Tisdale left voluntarily to make phone calls. One of them said she was on the phone dialing someone before she even got out the door and came back into the room at one point on the phone. Here, there's an absolutely clear, crystal clear, factual issue. But it's more than that, because Ms. Tisdale herself admits that she was not removed. And she does it in 2 places, an audio recording and a deposition transcript. Now, the Attorney General's office wants to say this is not about Ms. Tisdale's conduct, and I'm not going to stand up here and talk about, you know, who put their hand on who. Although when my client and its agents are wrongfully accused of something, I am going to set the facts straight. But for the purposes of this motion, I don't have to go into any of that because Ms. Tisdale herself, in an audio recording and a deposition transcript, has admitted she was not forcibly removed from the City Hall auditorium. The audio recording took place minutes after the meeting concluded. And it's a conversation between Dr. Joseph Moses, a reporter named Aldo Naheed, and Ms. Tisdale. And here's what they said. Dr. Moses says, you've got two huge stories. Aldo responds, three. She got, and Ms. Tisdale says, kicked out. And then Mr. Naheed corrects her. Well, you did not get kicked out. And then he starts to say, and Ms. Tisdale says, well, okay, my camera. They would not let me film. Ms. Tisdale, although she swore she was forcibly removed from the City Hall auditorium in the complaint, she's the one who verified the Attorney General's complaint. Minutes after the meeting, after being challenged, says, it was just my camera. They wouldn't let me film. And here's the recording. It's in her own words. It can't be any plainer than that. The allegation that she was kicked out of the meeting is absolutely false. She was not removed. The allegation of the complaint that she was forcibly removed from the City Hall auditorium is absolutely false. And she admitted it minutes after the meeting was over. Ms. Campanella says this is someone being removed from a meeting. This is a man who is doing what he was instructed to do, picking up the tripod, still in the auditorium. The court can see there's a person sitting there, bench. We've not left the City Hall auditorium. Nobody's been removed from the City Hall auditorium. And he's moving it to the side. This is not someone being removed from a meeting. This is someone who was doing what he was instructed to do and moving the camera. The deposition transcript Your Honor, here is the copy of the deposition. I've got a condensed copy for you guys.
Thank you.
I've turned it to page 66, Your Honor, which is where I'm going to be referring to, but the court can actually read for several pages after this about the, because this is the portion of the deposition transcript where the removal from the meeting is discussed. Page 66, starting at line 3, I'm only going to quote one of the questions because it gets right to the heart. Did they make you leave the room? Did they make you walk out of those doors? The answer, no. At this point, I acquiesced. I said, okay, I'll stop. I'll put my camera in the corner. And for the next several pages, there are questions about why she left the room, what she did when she left the room. But what is unbelievably clear from this is that the allegation in the complaint that my client forcibly removed her from the City Hall auditorium is false. Judge, and what we're getting to is that the Attorney General is making the argument that the removal of the camera, the picking up and the moving of the camera to the rear and the side of the room is somehow, it's like they're arguing it's a constructive removal of the meeting, from the meeting. It'd be like, Your Honor, if this cell phone went off and I didn't do anything about it, and you instructed one of the deputies to come and take this cell phone away from me, and I don't let go, and they go dragging me back here to these doors, and we get to the doors, and while we're back here at the doors, I let go, and I set the cell phone down. Have I been removed from your courtroom? No. The answer is no. I've not been removed from your courtroom. Have I been removed from the City Hall auditorium when my camera is taken and is moved to the side? No, I've not been. If I voluntarily walk out this courtroom, I don't have a claim against you for removing me from this courtroom. When Ms. Tisdale voluntarily walks out of the City Hall meeting room and gets on the phone and starts dialing people, she's not been thrown out by the mayor. Now, I expect the Attorney General is going to say Mr. Tallant is comparing apples and oranges. He's talking about having a cell phone in a courtroom, which the court can instruct me to turn off, versus Ms. Tisdale having a camera that she's using to record. And I recognize those are two different issues. But in terms of being removed from the room, they're the exact same. If I walk out the door voluntarily and you don't throw me out, I don't have a claim against you. If Ms. Tisdale walks out the City Hall auditorium voluntarily, which is what she did, she doesn't have a claim against the city or against the mayor or against anyone else for being, as she put it in the complaint, forcibly removed from the auditorium. That's my argument on the factual issues. I have argument on the issue of attorney's fees. Because in the summary judgment motion, the Attorney General asked for attorney's fees to be awarded. Does the court want me to present that argument as to why I believe they're not proper, or are you going to wholly not even deal with that, and you're going to look at that on another day at another time?
Well, I think the authority for the court to grant attorney's fees implies that the decision would be based on the entire record of the case. And I don't think that I can do anything but reserve those issues until we reach a point where the final decision or final judgment is reached on the entire case, in which case then I'll give whoever has the right to pursue attorney's fees the opportunity to convince the court that they should be awarded and to verify the reasonable amount that should be awarded.
Okay. Understanding that, that you're not planning on ruling on attorney's fees before we have a chance to come back and address that issue, I'm going to stop here. I'm not even going to get into my attorney's fees argument. And I'll sit down. Thank you.
All right. Any short rebuttal?
Yes, just very, very quickly, Your Honor. During that entire response that Mr. Tallant just gave, he neglected to address one real crucial thing. The fact that fully uniformed officer told Ms. Tisdale four times, ma'am, step outside. Don't know how you explain that in terms of keeping a meeting open. Second thing is, Mr. Tallant went talking about, you know, forcible removal, and she wasn't forcibly removed. If he wants to explain all that for purposes of, you know, explaining on behalf of his client that what happened, that's fine. But for purposes of this claim, he seems to be suggesting that to violate the open meetings provision, that it remain open to the public, you've got to physically pick somebody and throw them out of the room. That's not what the Open Meetings Act is all about. Means you got to leave it open to the public. A uniformed police officer stands outside, doesn't lay a finger on somebody and says, sorry, you can't come in. You're going to have to step outside. That's a violation of the Open Meetings Act. It doesn't take them pushing them. It doesn't take them removing them. It doesn't take them politely picking up their belongings and moving somewhere else. That's a violation of keeping the meeting open to the public. There's no technical proof involved. There's no show of force. Doesn't matter. All the things he just said were the things I cautioned you about. Immaterial facts for purposes of the elements of our claim. And whether or not she was forced out physically, doesn't matter. Her recordings don't matter. What she did afterwards, don't matter. She was told in no uncertain terms by a police officer of the City of Cumming, step outside, step outside, step outside. Just to clear up one couple things. The recording that was played for you, which again is utterly material to this claim, is taken out of broader context. And I don't consider her statement in response to what Dr. Moses said or Mr. Nyed, well, okay, they would not let me film. I don't think that's an admission that she was not, that she was, asked to leave the meeting. I don't think that is, and it's immaterial.
Also, the deposition that was just read, it's also read conveniently out of context. The excerpt that Mr. Tallant just read about her acquiescing is just followed by the following. I did not volunteer the meeting area. Now, if you want to define the room out of the pointed doorway, I walked out from there, yes. But from here, the officers escorted me by holding both of my arms and walking me out. Again, I'm not here to quibble about immaterial facts. I accept what they say is true for purposes of our motion. But I submit to you again, telling someone to step outside repeatedly, and it doesn't matter if there's use of force or not for purposes of our motion. So I'll just leave it at that for your consideration.
All right. Because of the agreement, I'm not going to venture any further into an analysis of the facts at this point. However, I will reiterate what I said earlier, and that is this. Where each party submits the limited evidentiary offering that you're allowed to do on a motion for summary judgment, the court is required to consider each of you correct. So I've got to look at you and say, your analysis of Ms. Tisdale's statements on the recording are absolutely correct. But on the other hand, I have to look at the other side and say your affidavits that you've submitted as to those issues that were addressed are absolutely correct. The end result, though, is that if there's a dispute, then whoever the fact finder may be, and that may even be a mystery himself, has to evaluate the weight and credibility of Ms. Tisdale's presentation and her testimony, the chief's testimony, the mayor's testimony, any other observer's testimony that is identified as a witness. And that trier fact also has to establish the value of any of the recordings or videos that are submitted as evidence. You have here one recording which was made by a person who is not a party to the case but is the target of the complaint. You have another recording that was in fact made by the authority of the defendant to the complaint. Neither one of those recordings are absolute on their face until a trier fact has analyzed weight and credibility. Those are the things that I have to struggle with in regard to how far I go in resolving disputes over evidence. I will say that again, and I'm sure the city has heard it more than they want to, that there appears to be no doubt that the mayor issued a limitation on what is clearly authorized under law, and that is recording in a meeting. Now, there's also no question in this court's mind that a presiding officer, whether it be a mayor or county commission, always has the authority to maintain the decorum of a meeting, even though that person also has the responsibility of complying with the sunshine law. But nothing has been submitted that I'm aware of by the city to say that the camera was loud or that the camera was placed in an inappropriate position or that the persons accompanying the camera were disruptive or that there is a place provided for cameras that was not utilized. None of these defenses have been raised, even that
there is a standing rule that authorizes recording. You know, all of those are not violations of the Open Meetings Act, but none of those defenses have been raised. So I don't, you know, I can't anticipate a defense. I can only look at the evidence and make a decision as to whether there's been a violation. I have appreciated your, both of your positions in regard to this. There are some interesting questions. I'll be honest with you, even though it will be a challenge to resolve it, I hope y'all are successful in your effort to resolve the case. Let me make one point to you that I always make as the final point of my spiel on mediation. There's one often overlooked rich reward for successful settlement or mediation, and that is a single word called finality. Finality is what you get when you know it's all over. There are no more expenses, there are no more attorney's fees, there are no more sleepless nights, there are no more issues to worry with, and finality can only be accomplished by you in agreement between now and August 9th. So I wish you the best in finality. Thank you. Let me return your transcript. Let's see, the clerk's file. I'm going to wait until y'all all be seated. There's no point in waiting on me.
Presentation, would that assist you any?
Yeah, it would if I have to make a resolution. I'll tell you what, why don't you do this? Just send me any of your outlines or slide presentations or whatever along with your supplements.
Okay.
If we get to that point beyond August 9th, same thing with the Attorney General's position. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Stand up before the public. Hi.
Good job.
Really good job.
Yeah, you too.
PowerPoint.